Paul.
Hello.
Hello. SummerSlam, it's baby. SummerSlam,
yeah.
The biggest like, oh, yeah, party right. of the summer goes England.
It's probably rainy, though.
In August? Maybe, but yeah. probably not. It's
That's what I know about England, okay?
It rains in August. It does rain in August, but it's, you know, once or twice in August. You know, you're not expecting a lot of rain.
Yeah, it's probably very, like,
it gets
normal.
It gets really hot in August now. In, like, 2024, 2023. It gets extortionately hot to the point where we can't handle it. Because our buildings are designed to keep the heat inside. And so, like, people will always say, oh, it's not that hot in the UK, right? Because they'll compare the temperature in the UK to, like, other countries. And they'll be like, oh, it gets way hotter here, or way hotter there, and we don't complain about it. But there's a difference in, one, there's a difference in the way that, like, genuinely, skin evolves with the heat, right? So, like, genuinely, like, UK skin is a little bit more sensitive to heat because we just haven't experienced it as much. That's just how evolution works, right? But two, our buildings are all designed to keep the heat inside. So when there's a fucking heat wave, our buildings get really, really hot. So, yeah, it's bad.
I've seen about the exact opposite happen here, like in Canada and stuff like that. Our winters are no longer scary, like, winters. Like, it's like, oh, man, it's, like, now, like, minus 20. It's, like, the highest you're ever going to see, I feel like. I've not seen anything higher than, like, minus 20 something for like a very, very long time. And I don't live like in like the coldest fucking parts of Canada or something like that. I'm sure there are still areas that are getting, you know, those crazy minus temperatures, but like as a whole, it's like the summer, the winters start a lot later. Like it feels like fall for pretty much the entire last like quarter or two quarters, I guess, of, like the year. And then January is right around when it starts to get like kind of cold, but like, and when we do get snow, of course, it's a metric fuck ton of snow because it's like a fucking polar vortex or some shit like it is this time.
Uh-huh.
But just in general, things are not as cold over here as they have been, at least in my younger years and stuff like that. It used to be.
I think things are getting slightly colder here. We're getting more snow.
That's so fucking crazy, man. This shit's so fucked up. It's like,
I can't say for sure, though. I feel like winters go through a similar sort of pattern as usual. I've been trying to fuck with the crop here, guys, while Tucker was talking, because it doesn't look quite right to me, but this is the best I can do. So, yeah, I'm not going to fuck with it much more. It doesn't look too bad, but I know it's not quite right. Before we progress the show, we need to have a look at the ticket prices.
Oh, yeah, okay. What do you want to do with that?
So I don't necessarily want to like game it really hard, because I know I did do the gaming it really hard thing about 6 months ago, and I found out exactly what we would need to like sell it out or whatever. Obviously the industry's changed since then anyway. I also just don't remember what my results were. But I can tell you for a fact we're not getting a respectable number if we stick to premium. So we can do this by show by show, by the way, so don't change this. Go to SummerSlam.
Oh, can we?
Yeah. I'm almost certain you can. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure you can change it show by show.
Yeah, pricing.
Yeah.
Default
would be premium, because that's our default.
Oh, you're right. That is our default. Good call.
Normal? So that's the thing. So I think we should make a decision to just go with it. We shouldn't test it. There's a chance that normal, we end up not selling that much as well. Because I'm not saying that we want to sell it out. Because obviously, if we go very cheap, I think we'd sell it out.
Oh, of course.
I think what we're aiming for is
we can do it for free, and I think the people might show up. I don't know.
I don't think we necessarily need to be like, oh, it's 90k or our egos get hurt. But
yeah, no.
I think the aim should be around 70 at least. If you want to say no, the ticket price is the ticket price, and the number of Brits, you know, normal, I think is reasonable.
I do too.
Or we could skew it onto the cheap and probably get close to a sellout.
Like, what do you want more? Like,
I don't know. I think I'm happy with normal or cheap. Yeah, I mean, cheap would obviously be safer for to pop a big number, but normal would like be us valuing our brand more, I guess.
Yeah, I would imagine normal.
I don't think there's any chance we sell it out to normal. Whereas I think there is a chance we sell it out on cheap. I guess is the other thing to say.
I just mean, do we really care about selling it out? Like,
I'd prefer to sell it out than to not. It's not the end of the world, but you'd agree with that, right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. If it's one or the other, of course, I would rather sell it out and stuff like that. But I didn't think of that as like, honestly, I didn't think we even would be able to sell it out, like, no matter what. I kind of assumed we were doing like 60K here, but
we're the biggest wrestling brand in the world.
Yeah. Like, yeah. By far. Yeah. We are an insane juggernaut at this point, and nothing will stop us.
So we, you know, I feel like it would reflect badly on them.
We lost our biggest direct, like, revenue stream, and we walked it off. Like, it was like, okay.
Hey, wait, we haven't walked it off yet. All right, let the year come to a close before we declare this year a success.
True, yeah, yeah.
What I would say, but it would look, if we had 20,000 in this place, if we had to, like, close down a section or something, it would look bad for us.
The 07 Twitter people ready to dunk on us. We gotta gotta sell it out or else they'll kill us.
I suppose that's a good point. There's less sources of criticism in 2007.
Yeah, nobody cares. We could just tell them we sold it out and then show a blocked off area and then just continue to say, no, we sold it out. There were people there.
You sort of swung me over. You want to do normal. I'm sort of just dragging out the argument. I think normal's fine. Let's do normal.
Yeah, I just don't think, like, that societal pressure of, like, if they don't sell it out, they
I do still think
stupid.
It would be a bad look. I still think that, you know, there would be something to it, you know. We couldn't do... We'd shoot it in a way that was timid, if you know what I mean. We'd sort of shy away from certain areas of the arena. And I think that would be a bad look. But I don't think it's the end of the world.
I'm trying to think. I'm like, did AEW do that? They didn't sell it out. They didn't get close. Like,
no, I was talking about like 20K, 40K or something like that, you know?
Oh, I don't think it'll be that.
Even 60K, there will be a lot of empty seats.
That's true. 60K would be a little... Because what did... Okay, well, the AW number is either 84 or 70 or something in between that. So who knows?
I mean, hold on. Let me... Also, I want to do a little reality check on this as well. 2007 yep. National League... playoffs.
Oh yeah, how hot is sporting in general?
Yeah, here it is, Conference National. Okay, so all right, so the National League playoffs. So this is the non-professional leagues in England. The top of the right. Non-professional leagues, they get to play at Wembley at the end of the year to decide who gets to go onto the professional leagues. And right. they only got 40,000 people in Wembley for that one.
Oh my god.
So,
oh my god.
It wouldn't look that bad if we did a shit number. I was thinking that they might have sold the place out because, although actually I'm looking at these, man, they really, these attendances over the years have been really bad for this. Surely it goes up, right? COVID year, fuck that. 2020. Oh my god.
I don't know if it does. God. Yeah. I think the consistent problem with Wembley is like too big. There's nothing.
Oh
good, really.
No! I mean, like, there are. It gets sold out often. Like all of the professional leagues will sell it out, and then usually I think, and then obviously the women's national team sells it out now. I think.
I guess my thinking is like, I guess I was thinking like concerts and stuff like that probably.
Oh yeah.
When I was like, oh, I don't think anybody sells that shit.
But it's a football stadium, you know. It's not designed to sell for concerts. Attendances. I'm interested now. I want to see Wembley Stadium attendances. I wonder if it's there. Probably not, right? Surely. That would be cool, though. Surely there's a list of attendances out there somewhere. Maybe not.
I'd look up the actual 07 SummerSlam number, but we'll beat that. So.
Yeah, we'll smash that.
Whatever the hell that is. I don't care if it's like 15 or like 8. It's probably close to 8, honestly. But
we're actually probably closer to like 80,000 capacity anyway for us.
It's only recently that I really keyed into the fact that like WWE attendances haven't always been like strong. Like, I've always just kind of thought people go to that shit, and then it's like No, there have been multiple times where, like, it just dries up and their TVs are like, we have, like, 6,000 people here, I guess. Like,
they're doing
here for Raw.
They're doing stadium shows starting 08, though, for Mania, like, every year, though, to be fair.
Yeah, I guess they kind of realized, like, I don't know. It was such a smart thing to make that, like, a pilgrimage thing, you know what I mean? Like, everybody, you just gotta come. Bring everybody. Come to the place and
see the thing. Yeah. I get what you mean.
Maybe that's also, like, just other companies piggybacking it off of that made it like that. But.
Yes. It was always sort of that as well, to some extent.
Yeah, obviously.
And I do think the stadium stuff really hurt the event, which is why we don't do it.
Yeah, no, Mania should be in arenas, thank you.
It's just hard, right? Because then it becomes a crazy scalper's paradise.
That's true. That would probably be a concern for us, yeah.
So, yeah. Alright, let's go normal, though. Let's see what we get.
You wanna get any celebrities?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You wanna get, like,
spend a mil on it.
Oh, shit, okay, that... I don't know who a British B-list celebrity would be, but...
Just get someone to sing. Get Ozzy Osbourne out there singing.
Oh, that's it. Ozzy will do it for, like, a mil.
That should be live music then instead, yeah. Hey, get rid of the celebrity thing.
Yeah, okay.
Just do live music. Major band. Yeah, major band. Or star band, yeah. I saw you hovering. I didn't
accurate.
And we should also definitely build a special set.
Oh, yeah, Jesus.
500k sounds reasonable?
I would say probably, since we're trying to sell it at, well, we're get close to selling it out, probably a more minimalist stage, kind of, less...
Yeah? Something like the MSG stuff they do with the little block. I like the idea of that. And a long ramp.
Yep.
Yeah, that sounds cool. Also, we'll start early enough, I feel like. Oh, it's hard. When are we running this show?
3 hours, so.
Oh, man, that's actually a really difficult logistics concern, huh?
Isn't it theoretically... Oh, shit, you're right. How the fuck do we do this? Fuck.
I'm leaning towards an afternoon show in the UK.
I think we have to, right? UK afternoon, and then...
It's early morning for US.
Does that make sense, or does it make more sense to do it in the evening in the UK, and that's like noon or so in the US?
That's bad, though. I guess it's a Sunday.
Is it? Is it bad?
I guess it's a Sunday. I was thinking people would still be in work, which they would, but less.
Yeah, some sure would, yeah, but...
I think it's close to like... I think it's close to like 40% of people work on Sundays. To be fair.
Wow. Jesus. What a dystopia.
I mean, the weekend... what I will say is the weekend concept is bullshit. It doesn't matter whether you work Sundays or not. It matters how many days in the week you work. Because if I work Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, then that's that's completely reasonable.
Yep, that's fair. That's a week, yeah.
On the other hand, I feel like if you work Monday through Saturday, that's bullshit. Or even Monday through Friday is bullshit, to be honest with you.
No.
4 days on, 3 days off is absolutely a minimum for me, though.
I'm pretty sure that's like, there are like multiple fucking studies that come out every fucking year that are like, this is way more efficient. Employees are happier. More things get done when they're around. Like.
Yep. You know. Yeah, I guess your idea is okay. We can start at 8 in the UK, maybe. Yeah, that seems reasonable.
Yeah.
Bell time at 8.
Alright. It's time to see the folks. Who came out?
Who's here?
How many? There's nothing else we need to do, right?
I don't think so.
Okay. Oh, yep. Fair play, game. Fair play. This. Did we sell it to the British?
I don't think we have a British deal.
Oh, yeah, maybe we dropped it. You're right. Oh, yeah, we do. Oh, no, we do. Sorry, I saw Wales. South Wales, and I went, there it is.
Did we add the British to WWE.com Direct?
I think we did. We did not.
Shit. Well, there you go. They better come.
They better show up. Yeah, there you go. It's all right. You'll get DVDs. You'll get DVDs. Don't worry about it. Okay, yeah. Just this one, then?
Yeah, I mean, that's all we can do, right? I think.
Oh, yeah. Fair play. All right.
This number will be insane. Oh, that's not good. That's not good.
No.
That's actually really bad.
Very foreboding. But the economy and the wrestling industry are bad. Okay? Okay?
Okay, okay, okay.
See, it's better. It's, hey! Hey! 60? I told you. I told you 60.
I mean, I was hoping for 70, like I said.
I know. But I told you.
Why did we do it?
Where is this place?
Southern.
Look!
Okay. All right, fine. We got there in the end.
Wembley Arena.
Nope, stadium.
That's West Point Arena, anyways.
So, yeah. Although we'll maybe do Wembley Arena tomorrow. Although maybe I don't know if we can. It's only 12,000. We might be able to do that.
Oh yeah, we could do that. Well, there you go. Yeah, we were just in a bad section of England, I guess.
Yeah. Whew.
Oh, yeah, okay, sure. What's going on? Okay, whoa, chill.
Relax.
It, like, threw that at me. That was terrifying.
Shit.
What's up, game?
What's up? Who's there?
Oh, man. Nash and Taker are throwing bombs in the back. You've ruined this night.
I like to think these two are just discussing politics in a civil manner.
I think this version of Taker agrees with Nash, though, on a fair amount of things.
I'm sure.
Oh, never mind. We're good. Yeah, she's just like, I'm pretty sure you can't do this to me.
I don't want to go out in England. And Taker's like, but come on, brother, let's go.
I don't want to see them. I don't want to look at them.
I don't agree that they're people, Taker. That's just not very tolerant of you, bro.
That's fucked up, man. You can't say that. Okay, good.
We'll call our matches in.
Yep. What the hell's opening this?
I think it's either the All-Star Raw Tag Team, or it's the Cruiserweight title match.
Interesting. I thought this could be...
Oh, no. I think that's right in the middle of the card, where it can be nice and slow. There's no way that's opening, bro. I don't know what version of Triple H or Elijah Burke you think we have, but it's not them. Those men are putting on a mid-card affair for sure.
I guess my idea was just get Triple H out there early, and he's somebody that people like and know. And
that sounds like you're pitching the All-Star Tag Team, then.
No, not this one. Where is it?
That is the All-Star Tag Team match.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we can do that.
Okay, I mean... So I do think it's an option.
The timing for Chava.
Yeah, I do still think we could. I mean, we could put it second, or even third. Really, I mean, I don't really. We could even go right before the World Heavyweight Title match if we were going to sell the story. But, but these aren't people would know. Your pitch was people would know, and so that's more of the All-Star Tag Team match. To be fair. Although, if you want the banger open, I feel like the Cruiserweight title match has a chance to be the best match on the show. It was last year.
Could maybe also be this.
Nah, I think that's like top of an hour. Like, it could be that, but I feel like it's too long. Like, the opening, oh my god, it's SummerSlam! It'll burn out by the end of this match. This is like a 20-plus minute affair.
Fair play. Yeah, alright. Cruiserweight title.
Okay, I'm done. Actually, I'm coming around on the All-Star Tag Team now. I don't mind. What's your instinct?
It's probably to go with people know.
Okay.
So,
because I like this as a start to the show as well. It's fairly inconsequential.
What the fuck?
I think we had him on an SNME.
Oh, yeah. It's like, what the fuck? We should do that, though, to be fair. Oh, we'll probably flip him for the matches and stuff like that anyways, won't we?
Yeah, that sounds good. So why don't you make this one of the teams? Yeah. So it's a bit easier on you. I think SmackDown's actually the more frequent team.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, that's actually, that's a really good show. Okay, yeah. Good call, good call.
Yeah. We're starting with the tag team match. We decided.
Oh, fuck, you're right. And now I have to change it again.
It's fine, though. You'll have to change it slightly less than if you had gone the other way.
That's true. Fuck, who the fuck are my Raw refs? What the fuck?
George Ackenschmitten's on Raw.
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah. That's him. That's all him.
We have so many people on this fucking in this company.
And like half of them are fucking not very good. Either.
There's actually a genuine chance we have more non-wrestling talent than wrestling talent now because we let a lot of people go.
Yeah, that's literally entirely possible.
I think we've got around 70 workers. I feel like we don't have 70 backstage staff, but it's probably close to 30 or something.
Probably.
7 is what I'm thinking on this.
Yep, I like that. Big, like, kind of house showy.
Yeah. I think Kennedy's winning, yeah. He's probably going to pin Dextro. And then I think a Cruiserweight title match goes in right next.
Yep. God damn it. Who the fuck is Chad Patton? He's on Raw, at least.
Maybe, hold on. Open up the roster. Filter SmackDown refs. Let's just give you a picture in your mind.
Oh, that's fair. Good call. SmackDown. No, not Perception. Roll. Star referee, bro. Wow, okay. SmackDown's core is tight.
Jimmy's the head ref, right?
Yes. What the fuck are the Raw guys then? Wow, what a group. All I have to say, what a group.
Wow.
Give me Nick Patrick, I guess.
Shit. That's Road Agents.
Yeah. I'm looking at here.
You haven't played DW in a bit, have you?
No, I haven't touched Burning Hammer for a minute, honestly. And I wanted...
I think Ricky Steamboat tends to be the Cruiserweight guy,
yes.
Right?
Yeah. Yes, thank you. Jeez.
I had 17 in mind for this one.
Wow.
You seem hesitant. Go on. Talk me through it.
That's long.
Is it? It's Chavo Guerrero and Evan Bourne. It's the best wrestler in the company versus a hot kid who can do a lot of cool flips.
Fair. It's fair.
I remember the result of this match, so we've got to sell it.
I do. I have put that in my head now.
I'm not willing to go too much shorter than that, but I can take a few minutes off. But I really, I want to instill that, like, I think Evan Bourne is, like, really good. Like, he's raw, he's green, but, like, he's so exciting, he's so fun. He's, like, he is, like, a new model, right? He's, like, genuinely the future of the division. And, like, Chavo is the best wrestler in the company. Like, he's genuinely he is the best wrestler. Like, think of we should be treating Chavo Guerrero like IRL WWE treated Shawn Michaels in this era.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. You're right. That's exactly where my brain went too. I was like, oh shit, he's like Shawn, isn't he? Oh god. All right, yeah. Anyways, Evan Bourne wins.
Yeah, he does. Not the match you're expecting Chavo to lose tonight.
No. Slow build it, I assume?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Chavo's gotta put some structure on this.
Ah, understandable, Chavo.
Yeah. It's clean, though, so I'm feeling like we just say, fuck you, Chavo.
Yep. Yeah. Done.
How much time have we taken up with those two matches? 28 minutes? Maybe we'll have about... Yeah, we could do, like, a climactic match here, something like... Maybe one shorter match into a climactic match. Do we have any shorter matches? Only the women, really. So not really.
Yeah.
So I kind of like the idea of going Ken Taker here into the ladder match.
Yep. That's kind of where my head was at.
Oh, yeah. I forgot. I had a little bit of a different idea in my mind, but now I remember what this match is going to be. So, yeah, I think it fits here.
Motherfucking goddamn brand vision making me think all the time. Sting's probably got the main.
Everybody else on SmackDown. SmackDown main, I assume you mean. Not the main main.
Yes, sorry. You could just do both this and the other one, though. Steamboat's got the tag and the cruiserweight.
Is Steamboat doing the tag? I feel like we give someone else something. Unless you find it just Sting and Steamboat being the only agents tonight. Also, Taker could main. Taker could agent the world title match.
Yep, okay.
This is a thought.
What if we...
Is Dusty SmackDown or is Dusty Raw?
He's Raw, okay. But my brain was like, jump across the aisle and grab either him or Arn even for this.
For this? I don't mind that. I think that could be fun.
Yeah, I think I probably know what direction you're going with this, even though I really don't. Yeah.
I would have been against that for the world title match, but I think this one you could totally bring in a Raw guy if you wanted to.
Yep. Yep.
All right, cool. All
right, yeah, we'll get Arn on this.
2 minutes on this. And then, yeah, Shamrock wins via stoppage. Maybe? Stoppage? So he's going to break his leg.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
is that a stoppage? Is that a technical submission?
Yeah,
that sounds good.
Oh, shut the fuck up, Tig.
I'm okay to protect him. But if he complains, we're going to take it off.
All right, bye-bye.
Oh, but it's the Undertaker, though.
It is the Undertaker.
It's the Undertaker.
It is the Undertaker.
But if he complains about these, though, then he's not getting them. All right, fine.
He's game. All right,
you know, respect that dead man.
Did I have the right comps on that? I must have. This one we'll give to Charles. And who'd you want to do? Somebody different.
I was thinking that, because this isn't really a cruiserweight match, right? It's a ladder match.
Yeah, that's fair. Maybe my perception is just fucked. Maybe there are like good road agents here. Oh, Hayes is pretty good. Slaughter's pretty good too. So, Sergeant Slaughter.
What?
Weird. Who's doing this?
This is more of your thing. I'm looking up length right now.
Okay.
So it's all on you.
It's either Slaughter or Hayes. I guess theoretically, Hayes. Sure.
I'm thinking 21 from what I'm seeing.
Yep.
And then, yeah, the Lundrick are going to retain.
Lundrick forever.
Lundrick can get her forever, man. He never going to go away.
Never, ever.
I think it's time for Revolution here.
Hell yeah.
Let me come in about all three singles titles.
So you knew what this was, right?
She's going to turn on...
Immediately turn.
Not immediately. We're going to have a match here. Like a six-minute match.
Yeah.
Okay. I feel like this shouldn't go that long, but it needs a little bit of time.
This isn't the last Raw thing.
There's two more Raws after this.
Is there? Okay, yeah, there's
Yeah, there's the IC title match and the WWE title match. Should we give Base Taker the women?
No, Base Taker? Holy shit. I just want to check this too, sorry.
Okay.
Very particular with this shit, if you haven't noticed. This shit matters. Korea is just...
No, I agree. On my golden canvas, I always do it as well.
Korea is just not good. Lombardi just is not good. How is Ted a better road agent than Dusty? Get out of here. Get on my face.
I think while we're here, Seth McMahon to not be a road agent anymore, because he was like, specifically, I'm going to agent my own stuff, and he's not on TV anymore, so he doesn't need to agent anymore.
Flair is also just not here at the moment. That's what's going on.
He has a potential to be a color commentator? Interesting. Okay, we can change that because his microphone is 92.
Yeah, we can fix that.
Yeah. That's kind of cool, though. Colon Flair? That's kind of cool.
That's a menace to society-ass fucking commentary table.
I like the idea that Flair will, like, take him under his wing, you know? I think that could be really cool. And even, like, that could create some cool, like, referencing down the line where Cole has, like, this period in his early career where he was, like, mentored by Ric Flair. That would be really cool. I think we should definitely do that.
All right, we're going to reach across the aisle and give this one to Sarge.
Okay. Is Sarge a SmackDown guy?
Yeah.
Okay, sure.
It just happened to work out like this, I guess. I don't know.
I've convinced myself down to 5 minutes. I think 5 minutes is a reasonable length of time.
Yep.
I feel like there's a turn option, but I don't think you need to. But yeah, I think we just use the turn option. I don't think Melina's going to win. I think Victoria is going to be the winner. Over, not Mickey James. So it's
Maria. Hell yeah.
Sorry, Maria.
I guess.
So Maria to be turned on by. I think that's the correct way of doing it. It'll tell you in the note. Yep.
Thank you, game. It does not matter to me.
That's right.
We
don't. I don't want to add the Mickey one as well. You can, but because I think that collection of notes will imply that it'll be the finish. Is Serena a babyface or is she a heel?
Good ask. She's a babyface.
I guess set her to turn. Games, I don't like it. I don't care.
Don't matter.
Don't fucking matter. Ooh. Yeah, I think maybe we do the world title match before the IC title match. I'm down to do the double main event instead. What do you think?
This is where my brain was going, but
yeah, I think I'm usually a double main event guy, but I kind of like the IC title match in between this time for some reason. It works in my head.
This is Jimmy.
Jimba.
Taker.
Hell yeah. With his broken leg.
I didn't do comms on that last match. All good. I'll have to go back.
I think I had this as a longer one. For these two. No, there was a cage, but this is not a cage. This is if Chavo gets disqualified or Cannondale loses the title. And if Batista loses, he can never fight Chavo for the title again.
Big.
Because we already did the short version of this, I think. Their first match, I believe, was a shorter match.
Yeah, and it was fucking awesome. No, it was the cage, apparently, that was fucking awesome.
Can you click on those, or will it not open?
I can just, like, hold on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just chill. He's very concerned. It's like, what are you doing? not the show. 8.
I don't think any of these were on there. Oh, there. Okay. That was the cage. So that was 15. What was the OG match?
It's just on a SmackDown. There. That was also 15. What?
Oh, yeah. Alright, so it was.
Okay.
So I guess we've done longer matches. I don't know, man. I'm really conflicted. Part of me says this is a longer, like, Smoke and Mirrors-y main, where, like... No, because I think I wanted this to be, like, the Chavo is the guy, is him moment. But I do think that's still a longer match where Chavo out-wrestles him. And I think that's a cool story, where it's like, Chavo's fucking tired. It's like, he's worked so hard tonight. And there is a little bit of, like, chicanery. But it's not. It's clear that, like, the chicanery doesn't necessarily impact the outcome of the match.
Yeah, there's also this probably, like, underlying story of that whole thing of, like, Dave's better to finish it early.
And yes.
Every single one of these matches has gone longer than an ideal fight for Dave Bautista.
Yeah. That's cool.
One could even be longer.
Yeah, that sold me on the longer match now, yeah. I'm hovering around 20, but I'm really conflicted as to whether it's like an 18. 19, yeah, okay, so. Let's do 19 then. Open, slow build, decisive.
Yep. Because, yeah, like I put over the fact that, like, Dave is, I mean, out of his depth a little bit, especially going, like, this far into something like this. He's taken on a better wrestler.
Yep.
But also, like, Dave wants it, like, clearly, like, yeah. So badly. Like, that's the reason why he's still in this.
And he almost beats Chavo in, like, five minutes in, you know? He's that flurry. Yep.
He had his shot. Fuck.
Let's see if we can get Dave to agree to put Chavo over. I'm having in my mind a little bit of a, like, Chavo's going to lose pop at the start of the night, and then Dave's going to get pissed.
Oh, that's fair. Yeah.
So maybe just to have it in writing that he's fine putting Chavo over. There you go.
I'm willing to do that.
Cool.
These guys are a lot better than the Burning Hammer guys. Every single person is just, no, I don't want to lose to anybody. What's wrong? Why would you ask?
I'm the man.
Yeah, I'm like, no, you're not Toshizai. Stop it.
Toshizai is the man. This is why I made a belt for Toshizai.
You had a year and a half long title run, bro. Just chill, all right? We're doing something different for a bit.
See, he knows if he had stayed, I would have made him a belt. Just for him. Did you want to fix the comms? Sure.
Yeah. Like, I shouldn't get too far from that.
Oh, my God.
Jim Ross, still MIA. I don't know what happened to Jim.
I got fired.
Real? I think Jim could be a road agent.
Yeah, that could be cool. He could produce comms like Vince does.
Oh, that's big. That's big. So then Vince isn't yelling at people.
Yeah.
Us, we aren't yelling at people.
You probably have, but have you seen that CM Punk interview where he's like, I just turned it off. and then Jerry Lawler was like, you can't do that.
Oh, yeah. Fuck. Now, Kyoto. Is Kyoto ahead? No, Earl is. Oh, yeah, we have Earl still. That's based.
Nice.
We're now, like, post-Earl's actual time.
Ooh, if Dean Malenko hasn't done a match tonight,
that's
he's what, perfect
That's what
this.
I was saving Dean for. Yeah. That's why Slaughter got the women.
He comes change for this.
Oh, you're right.
This screams 14 to me.
Yep.
Yeah.
Perfect. Fucking put him in the ground, try. Put him in the ground.
Oh, yeah, Triple H is going to win.
Yeah, put him in the ground.
Open the size, no, tainted.
Yep.
Overbook.
Yep.
Outside interference finish.
That's the Triple H dope, brother.
Yeah, brother.
I've just realized that right now. Overbook literally is smoking mirrors.
Yeah. 100%.
Yeah, what'd you say, sorry?
Outside interference finish. Trish Stratus.
Hell yeah.
And then the rest of the new... Dolph Ziggler at ringside.
With his badass back.
Trips for days. Triple Mania soon to be. Full show of Triple H going over everybody. Hell yeah, brother. He's back. It's his time. He is entering to my time. Let's go.
And finally.
Oh. It's time.
I got dusty on this one, don't I?
I think that's the play.
Big dust and...
A battle, a generational clash. Two of
90 trillion minutes.
Two men who belong to the same generation. Two men who have achieved everything. Multi-time world champions each, going at it in front of 78,000 strong in Wembley Stadium. I'm thinking it's somewhere between 15 and 25.
Twenty-two,
is that too long for these guys? There's some fun here. Who's doing the heat here? Because it's neither of these guys really.
You're right, yeah. You're right. This is the thing that we talked about in the Orton thing all those years ago. Both these guys are better receiving.
Yep. 29, so Cena can do the five moves of Doom twice. But I also feel like, I don't know, I feel like we should, my heart says we need to be playing, I know this is a kind of a random thing to say, but remember, both these men fought Chris Benoit at this event, and I feel like we should be, like, structuring this match exactly like those matches. And they're, like, trading places being the Chris Benoit of this match for each other. I don't know if any of that's making sense to you.
It kind of is, a little bit, yeah. I'm like, it's tough. For those guys.
Because Benoit's like proving, like, Benoit was the guy who made these guys who they are today in a way. And so they're both sort of like trying to live up to that. But so they're like sort of both flashing back to those Benoit matches. I'm kind of talking myself into this. It's kind of wild, but I think it works in a way. Like, Orton's heat segments are him trying to be Chris Benoit. And Cena's heat segments are him trying to be Chris Benoit.
I like that, and I think like there's a lot of cool little things you could do with that. Orton doing a suicide dive at one point.
Cena doing a bit more submission stuff, I think.
The Cena Benoit match is real, but I've never seen it.
I don't remember which one is that. When did they have their match? Because it wasn't SummerSlam.
Did they not? I thought they did.
At least not for the world belt.
I know it wasn't SummerSlam, but I swear they fought each other at some point.
Oh, I'm sure they did, but I think it was only when Cena was on SmackDown, which is obviously pre-Cena.
Oh, fair enough then.
I might be wrong.
Yeah.
But I think so, because I think pretty much for the entirety of the time Cena's made, Benoit's like fighting for the US belt, I think.
Yeah, he's on like...
Or he's on ECW.
ECW.
Yeah. So... 19?
Yep. Oh, that's the same as the last match, though. Or not the last match, but the world title. We care.
A little. We could go a flat 20.
Hey, I get my 22. Whoa, crazy.
Oh my god, it's over. The greatest title reign of all time is over. Do we want to consider putting any notes? Probably not. I feel like they couldn't pull off the epic or the spectacle.
No, I think they're probably better to just do a wrestling
match. Did we have them wrestle on the Eddie tribute show? Can you click match history? It looks like the answer is no. I can't see it in there.
They've never had...
Are they both HOI inductees yet?
good ask. Yes.
Ooh.
Yes.
Let's do it. Once in a lifetime, baby.
Holy shit. This is the one.
It's at the top.
Thank you.
It's the bottom note of the match aims.
Good God. Good God.
I try to set this up so many times in my saves, and it never happens.
That is something that never just works out. We somehow did it, and I don't think either of us...
I think
there was, slight, like, signal away.
Because I remember thinking about doing that on the Eddie tribute show, and then specifically being like, oh, if we don't, maybe this could, you know, happen down the line. But yeah.
Yeah.
Big shit. Let's run the show. okay, after is before. So why don't you do your open stuff? Because you like that.
Yep. Sure. Image of Mr. McMahon. Rest in peace. That's the open now.
Should we stop with the Mr. McMahon open since he's not on the show anymore?
No, because he's dead. People know he's dead.
No. I don't want to... I specifically don't want mention of Vince being dead on this show. If we can avoid it. Unless you're like hugely against that. I think part of the point of the show should be like... We don't deal with that bullshit drama. It's just, this is a massive wrestling event.
That bullshit drama? And it's some dude died in a horrible explosion.
But we already did the whole, like, rest in peace Vince episode, and everybody said the show must go on, right? So let's actually make the show go on.
Fair enough.
In fact, also, part of the point is, everybody fucking hates Vince. So the only person who actually still cares is Johnny Ace.
True.
Yeah.
We're here with all the boys. And we should wheel out Hugo and the other one.
Hell yeah.
I don't even know his name.
Santo? No.
No.
Is he still here?
Carlos Cabrera.
Carlos Cabrera. Hell yeah. The gang.
Yeah.
There you go. Man, we used to do so much more for international audiences. We get the French commentary team. The Japanese. They've all just gone away. Damn.
Is Regal doing anything on this show?
No.
No. Cool.
Welcome to WrestleMania, apparently. Like we'll, five, I think, probably, right?
Sure. We'll wheel him out.
Oh my god, Taz.
No. It's a fucking... There's six people in this.
Why is Taz always like, nah, boss, let me just do it.
I mean, it makes sense to me. Let's do like an intro video featuring John Cena, I guess. Hyping up, you know what I mean. You've seen the start of WWE pay-per-views.
Hype package.
Yeah. Like 3 minutes?
Yep.
I assume that'll happen before the comms.
Fair.
Yeah, because there'll be that, and then the pyro, and then the comms. Kennedy rated on overness off screen as the comms introduce us to what's about to occur. Probably should be the Raw comms.
Big tag. Big day.
Large.
Who the fuck?
Jerry Lawler. Let's have an angle after the match where Kennedy raises Shelton's hand and Shelton will like shy away and then Kennedy will like juke him and then give him a big smile and then raise his hand and then they leave as friends. And they get over this.
Big.
Like 3 minutes.
Big. Will they, won't they? All the angles should be big or something.
I got off the plane. Three.
Six? Four?
Three. I don't want to structure the build-up to this one. Well, I like the idea that one of the SmackDown interviewers interviews Kaz here.
Yep. Okay.
Roddy's there. But it's Kaz who talks. And he says...
Chris Marshall asks him, Frankie Kazarian, you son of a bitch, you... Answer my questions. They said you would never be world champion. How do you feel? Dude, that was the craziest shit I've ever seen in my life. I was like, she's cutting a promo on Ray. She's not interviewing you.
Did you watch any more of that video?
I got about halfway through it.
Some of that JBL stuff's really bad.
Yeah? Fuck, okay. I'll have to watch it. Like, unironically, yeah. I'll have to watch it.
I don't know. I think they go a bit too far with some of that shit. Evan's not there. I wanted to make that very clear. you can put him there off screen if you want, but yeah, he's not present. Because he's getting ready for the match.
I see. Yep.
Six, four to six. Is this gonna progress anything?
I don't think so. No.
Okay, then just four works for me then. Actually, two works for me if it's not going to progress on anything. Fuck it. Nice, short, pacey. Yeah, I think that's enough, honestly. That's just the match. Kaz and Evan celebrate afterwards, and Chavo shakes his hand. I think that's a good angle.
Yep.
This Chavo's not a bad guy. I think you could rate Chavo at Overness and nobody else. I think that's a reasonable thing to do here.
Fair play. Big human.
Four. Make sure Way of the Warriors on the Cruiserweight title match. Undertaker video package.
Yep.
Two.
Yep.
And then Shamrock comes out and calls out the Undertaker, and the Undertaker returns. You just rate them both on end, I think.
Yep.
The Taker's not really going to talk.
He's here!
And go six on that. Yeah, script them both. Let's get one of the SmackDown announcers in the ring to interview Ken after the match.
Hell yeah, man. Undertaker's on the ground, dead.
Winner interview, maybe. Yeah, post-match, I like that. Yeah. Six on that.
Yep.
Interview with Chavo, I think, at this point. Would be cool.
Yep, yep, I like that. I was like, ah, fuck you. I'll do it.
Maybe Teddy can show up in this interview and be like, yeah, I want you to know, player. I think you're a great world champion, and I do really honestly want to wish you luck in the main event tonight.
Yeah, Travel could tell him to go fuck himself.
Yeah, basically. I'm going to do this not because of you, Theodore. I'm going to do this in spite of you.
Perfect.
Is Chavo in a storyline with someone? Surely he's in Way of the Warrior with someone.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So put Dave off screen on that angle as well.
Use that Teddy rub.
Yeah, baby. I mean, Chavo's also a killer on the mic.
Yeah, yeah. Feel like cut back to the comms and they could be like, scary ladders.
Yep.
Ladders be scary. Gonna see some fucked up things right now,
especially with the Hardys. So,
yeah, have your children leave, please.
Oh, I would do. Wait, hold on. Okay, never mind. You've done it now. I would have done this a different way,
yeah,
but
yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. I guess they're not in anything, so I can give them a chance.
Yeah, it works. Are the Hardys in anything? I feel like you might maybe put the Hardys on here as well.
Oh, yeah, true. Honestly, yeah. Jerry Lawler. we about to get crazy.
I always feel like with these angles, if the comms aren't the point of the angle, you should always try and put the subject there instead.
Fair play.
I'd say off-screen all of those boys.
Oh, yeah, good call. And then we get fucking crazy.
And then we get crazy. Don't think we need any afters there. If it was 2015, we'd obviously have the show of respect between the two teams, but I feel like we don't need that here in 2007. Triple H interview?
Yep, I like that. Do you have stuff for a Triple H interview?
Yeah, probably.
Okay, fair enough.
So I don't know if you think this is too blatant, but I'll have him talk about how he feels, you know, younger than he's ever felt. You know, these last couple of months has made him rethink things. There was a time where he thought the IC title would have been a demotion, but tonight he knows it's going to be the crown on a beautiful new year. And then maybe the end of the interview can be, it'll be good to not be the only person wearing gold in this locker room. And like the end of the interview can be the camera panning over to Trish Stratus with the women's title looking smug.
Big. Who is the other Raw interview guy?
It's just Amy Weber right now.
Yes, it is. Thank you. That's what I was looking for.
Put Way of the Warrior on the Hardys Lundrick.
Yep.
Otherwise known as the SmackDown storyline.
Yep. there. I'm like, where the fuck did it go?
Is Cena Orton, are they in a storyline? Presumably. Yes. Can I see it? Is it okay? Can we just leave it? Yeah, it looked good. What I would like to do, however, is little angles throughout the night, like showcasing that these two guys, exactly the story that I was going for. So like they came in basically the same time, they came up together. So like let's do like Cena's debut, the Ruthless Aggression thing.
Yep. I don't know how the fuck I wanna call this, whatever.
Didn't Randy Orton also fight Kurt Angle on his debut? Hold on.
I don't think so.
Found it here. Well, JR introduces him, that's kind of pog. He's fighting Stevie Richards, looks like.
Oh, massive.
Oh, that's really cool. He has a cool look at the start, you know? Oh, I really like that too. Okay, yeah, check that really early in the show. Like, before the Kaz interview, I'd say. Okay, next angle then is obviously Orton's debut. Was he a second, third generation superstar?
Oh, God. Here.
And then let's get whichever. There's one SmackDown announcer that hasn't done anything, right?
Nope. I've got all of them.
Okay, I'll just pick whoever. I think maybe Amy Weber does make sense for this then. Amy Weber, there immediately after that little vignette, is going to go talk to JR.
What's going on? I'm still back here for some reason.
About
I don't
like,
work here anymore. I just hang out.
You can take. Amy doesn't need to be rated.
Yep.
But Orton off screen. Because JR's going to talk about what it was like. You know, introducing Randy and the changes that's happened to him since then. Because obviously it's been 5 years and, I mean, so much has changed.
Yep.
And this can go 2 minutes.
Sure.
And I think you should go immediately after that third generation package. And then Cena beating JBL. Or maybe Cena beating Brock Lesnar. Let's start with that. For the US title at WrestleMania 20?
Yep.
Okay.
Let's go with that.
Might need to put that earlier. I know there's one in the previous segment, but I feel like we've got a few here.
Alright, yeah, sure.
Yeah, I like that, actually. And then we can do an interview with Brock Lesnar. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah!
And then Randy winning the IC title. I think he beats RVD for his first one?
Yep, I do believe so.
Yep, that looks good. And then in that same segment, we can have Cena beating JBL. I think maybe not right back-to-back, unless you like it back-to-back. But I think maybe some space on those ones, because they're quite far apart in chronology.
All right.
That works.
Yeah, all right.
That works for me, if it works for you.
Yeah.
Okay. And then, obviously, Orton beating Benoit. this very event.
Jim Ross should hammer fucking home that, like, this is the,
JR's not on comms?
No, I know. Okay. In the
interview. Oh, in the interview, okay.
Yeah, JR should hammer home that this is the, fucking, what's it called? The Grand Slam. Orton does it tonight.
There you go. Yeah, true. Yeah, I think you can go before the Triple H interview. I was going to say short little Melina package, but I feel like just Melina overness off screen works here.
Well, Mickey should come out and...
Yeah, we'll do that after.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, I didn't forget. I just think that, like, the comms should introduce this thing first before we jump right into the action.
Women.
No, Melina's rise. Oh. It's fine to do Mimi stuff, but sometimes we need to make sure we know what's going on in the angle. 1 minute. Because you know you forget. You're an old man.
I am.
There you go. Now you can do your angle. Marcus Corvon.
Marcus Corvon is here.
The we alpha male.
We got this other woman now. Woohoo!
She's our friend. That? She's my best friend.
Who the fuck is this?
She's my best friend.
New arrival, I guess.
She's like a four to me. Some entrances, some talking.
Now it gets AIDS because I have to, like, scroll down.
Well, booking big sports end shows does to you, Tucker.
Fun.
Serena Deeb overness off screen as the comms react to what the fuck just happened.
Who the fuck is that?
Probably the Raw comms.
Yep.
Actually, instead of this, Melina will just cut a promo with her new, with her full stable there. Seems better to me.
Revolution is complete. Woohoo! We did it. I just realized why Victoria is the only one with one name.
I didn't quite make that connection, but it's true.
I was like, damn, that's so weird that we would, like, change Melina to have her last name, but Victoria just gets, and I was like, oh, wait, no, that was intentional, wasn't it? Shit. Revolution!
Six.
I guess we don't care about keeping it 3 hours, eh?
I think we're a little over, yeah. I don't know. What do you think?
No, I'm cool with it.
All right. I think we got more to book here.
We are on nothing but our own provider, so.
Yeah. I was thinking 3.5 is fine. As long as that's what roughly we're at, which I think we will be.
Yeah.
Cena gets drafted to Raw.
Wow. Right now? Holy shit. I didn't know Eric Bischoff was back there to pull the balls.
And it must be him.
Yeah. Has to be. It's gonna confuse me so fucking badly many years from now. You're like, what the fuck were we doing?
No. Yep. Elijah Burke interview? With Dolph Ziggler present? Sabu. Is there a storyline for Elijah Trips already?
I think so.
Can I see it? Okay, cool. That's fine. Chuck Triple H off screen on this one. Actually, don't do that. Take him off. My apologies. No, get rid of Dykstra, get rid of Marcus. They're busy. But Dolph,
yeah, they can't even stand around while he talks.
No, they're recuperating from their match that they lost. Yeah. This one can be four. Randy Orton defeats Undertaker in the Hell in a Cell.
Got fucked up here. Something got fucked up here. Why is Dave down here? What the fuck? Game?
That's a good question. Just
did I do that? It must have been something I bumped.
Yeah, that's so. Fine. Just check it. Sure. No. After the Burke interview. And then yeah, that's fine. And then before, well, actually, move the Burke interview to the next segment. Yeah, I think that's what you originally did. So my bad. So I guess here, just Batista Chavo package, I think.
Yep.
Yep. Three on this, I think. Okay, now before this then, before the Burke interview, actually, let's do 1 minute Batista overness as he's reacting to his...
He's sad.
Like, I like the idea that he's like clasping his hands like, oh, I let it slip.
Damn.
And then we'll do the Burke interview, and then after the Burke interview, Orton defeats The Undertaker in Hell in a Cell. Then the IC title match. See the Orton package?
Yep.
And go two on this because most of it will have happened throughout the night.
Yep.
And that, I think, is that.
Hell yeah.
Wembley! Well, I did kind of want to maybe throw Regal out there to talk for 6 minutes, but I feel like it's too packed of a show now. So maybe do that as a pre-show.
Yeah, I like that.
Feels kind of bad that we're at Wembley Stadium and William Regal doesn't get to, like, wrestle, but whatever, I guess.
It does, doesn't it? Whatever. Yeah.
He would honestly, I don't know him that well, but I bet he'd rather wrestle in some smaller venues in England anyway.
That's probably true. It's all right. We'll get him on Raw. We're in England for the week.
That's true. So we will get him on Raw. You can even main event Raw. Fuck
yeah,
it.
Yeah, that works.
Him versus Elijah, maybe rebound match.
Yep.
To get Vince out there before the show as well.
I'm secretly not dead. Don't tell anybody. I'm only telling you because you're British and your brains won't be able to remember this in a couple hours, so see you around.
Ooh, big question. Do we ban alcohol at this event?
No.
Okay.
Crazy.
Our attendants would immediately drop down.
I don't want them to kill us, man. Dun, dun.
That is the show.
Yeah, alright, cool.
Unless you have any other things you want to add or change. Oh, is the... Never mind. Where the Warriors on the world title match, because it is the world title match. So it should be fine. John Cena defeated Mick Foley in a hardcore match.
What a time.
Eminem defeated Walker and Murdoch, Stevie Richards and RSD, and Dean Malenko and Charlie Haas to win the world tag team titles. Lundrick defeated Rey Mysterio and Jeff Hardy to retain the Cruiserweight titles. There's only one person different to that match this year.
What the fuck? You're right. That's crazy.
Tori Wilson defeated Mickey James and Trish Stratus. Chavo defeats Gregory Helms in a cruiserweight ladder match. Triple H defeats Shane McMahon. Hell yeah.
Yeah, something like that.
Edge wins the WWE title in an Extreme Rules match. Booker T wins the world title. Randy Orton defeats Hulk Hogan.
Holy shit, I goodbye, brother.
Did you forget about SummerSlam 2006?
I did. I'm so big for just goodbye, brothers. I'm out of here.
I love the idea. I don't know if you remember this, but when we signed Hogan, it was under the proviso that in the fiction, we agreed with him that he could beat Shawn at Survivor Series so long as he agreed to put Orton over at SummerSlam.
Yeah, that was good shit. That's good shit. All right, are we ready to go with this?
I'm ready.
All right. In 3, 2, 1. Hello, folks. Welcome to SummerSlam. Wow, I could have done that with a little more gusto. Jesus.
Welcome to SummerSlam!
Hooray!
It worked!
I wish I had an editor. I wish I bothered to edit. I would put, like, confetti or something. Imagine it, okay? Imagine it. That's how TW works. You're getting authentic content here.
True.
Yeah, we're in Wembley Stadium. The British have come, I guess. They're out there. A little scary looking, but that's okay.
They're walking down Wembley Way, getting some food, getting many some alcohol.
Yes. We are... What the fuck? We are not there. The projection for tonight, 77,500.
The announced attendance, 85,000.
Whatever that exact number is. Damn, we should have gotten that. That would have been so funny. Fuck. Yeah, 84,952. If I nailed that off the top of the brain, I'm sick in the head.
We didn't cheap out our tickets. You know, Tucker wouldn't have it.
Yeah, no, we would run with normal ticket pricing, which is technically cheapening out our tickets.
But... Hey, yeah, but only versus the premium that we charge for our arena events.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's SummerSlam.
It's the biggest party of the summer.
Big shit going on. We just go with it now. I forget how these things work now, these pay-per-view videos. It's been so long. Yeah, we're ready to do it.
Let's go.
Let's do it. Before we even go live, William Regal pops a big-ass rating by coming out. We got 78, actually.
Nice.
That's big. We got an extra 1,000 somewhere. Where'd they come from? Yeah, Regal comes out and waves to the folks and says hello, you know. He also says, see you on Raw. Come to Raw. I'll wrestle on Raw.
Yeah, maybe he can even take a few jabs about not being on the card. It's a pretty sure.
He can say whatever he wants. Yeah. And now we got our big hype stuff. There's no foreboding presence anymore over these events. It's very strange. We cut into excitement and happiness and not depression.
Yeah, well, usually, with most of these matches, we're going to run them down as we come to it. But because this is the main event, I do feel the need to sell our main event tonight. It is WWE title on the line, John Cena defending against Randy Orton. This is a generational clash. We've got arguably the greatest WWE champion in the last 2 years versus arguably the greatest world heavyweight champion in the last 2 years. It is going to be an absolute barn burner.
Hell yeah. We're going to check in with our commentary teams. Also kick over to the Spanish announced team here for a minute. We're here. We're out here. Yeah, Raw comms on Raw matches, SmackDown comms on SmackDown matches. Carlos Cabrera apparently debuted the gimmick. People thought it was all right. They're like, yeah, okay. Maybe we'll see more of him. I don't know.
I could see him as a staff member.
Yeah. Adequate. You know what? I'd buy that, actually.
I'd buy that, yeah. He gives me big staff member vibes.
Not all the way, though. Just like enough. Maybe he's not. Maybe he's secretly a worker. I can't tell.
Oh, shit.
Carlos Cabrera run is coming.
So yeah, before we move on, actually, I pitched the main. What's the thing on the show that you're most excited about, Tucker? And briefly tell the people about it.
Ah,
It can be the same as mine. It can be the same as mine. Just tell me why you're excited.
I got two things, and it's different than yours, actually.
Okay, you can do both, but you have to be really brief.
Oh, is it because this angle is like 2 minutes or something like that?
Sure, yeah.
We've got Chavo Guerrero defending the world title twice tonight.
Yep.
And then, well, not the world title twice tonight, sorry.
Well, two world titles, yeah.
Yeah, his world titles. He's defending both, two of them, tonight. Also, we've got the WWE tag belts in fucking ladder match. That thing's going to be crazy as shit.
Big SmackDown mark. All right.
Yeah, I'm a big SmackDown guy.
Now, I tell you what I'm excited about, Tucker.
Getting away from these British people. Yeah, let's go. Let's go. Yeah. Okay, fine. Oh, did something happen to you?
No, I'm just waiting for the next slide before I go on to what I'm excited about.
Oh, I see. There you go.
This tag team match. You see, recently Raw's had a new addition. Mr. Kennedy, one of the most must-see superstars in wrestling today, okay? He has beaten multiple former world champions over the course of his already short career. And if it wasn't for the injustice last year of having the Money in the Bank briefcase stolen away from him by Rob Van Dam, now governor of Michigan, then he would be world champion right now. He's got Batista's number, or he had Batista's number, and if not for the injustice of Theodore Long's GMing, he would be the world champion. Instead, he's broken out, he's on Raw, where immediately he was subjected to the welcoming committee of the new breed, and assisted by Shelton Benjamin. Although after Shelton came to his aid, Kennedy actually betrayed Shelton and attacked him. So tonight, can Shelton and Kennedy put their differences aside as two of the most exciting young prospects in the business, Benjamin and Kennedy, take on two more of the most exciting young prospects in the business, Marcus Corvon and Kenny Dykstra?
Funny how that works out, eh? This does pretty well.
And the superstars do stay on the same page as they pick up the win.
Afterwards, Mr. Kennedy is celebrating. He's happy.
He raises Shelton's hand, even.
Yeah, and Shelton Benjamin's like, get away from me. I'm not your friend. But after some coercing from Mr. Kennedy, like, come on, Shelton, do the thing. It's a big show. Look at all these nice people.
Look at all these Brits.
Yep. All these nice British, and he allows Mr. Kennedy to raise his hand.
Could this be the start of a new leaf for Mr. Kennedy? Kennedy.
Kennedy.
Kennedy. We get a video package showcasing John Cena's debut, iconic, of course, when he goes up to Kurt Angle and says the one thing that makes him different to everybody else is that he has ruthless aggression.
Words that have defined an era. Backstage, Crystal Marshall's here with Frankie Kazarian. I won't do the bit, actually. Never mind.
Frankie, you know, you've been a big proponent for Evan Bourne as he's preparing to take on Chavo Guerrero for the Cruiserweight title. What makes him capable of taking on one of the greatest cruiserweight champions of our time? Somebody who's not only the cruiserweight champion of the world, but also the heavyweight champion of the world.
Frank Kazarian says that, you know, Evan Bourne is different than anything that most people have seen before in this company. You know, the millennium, the whole thing here is we were bringing it up to a next level, moving things forward, pushing wrestling into the future, if you will. And if you look at Evan Bourne and what he can do in that ring, and you're going to see it tonight. I don't even really have to say any of this. You're just going to see it. But Evan Bourne is ridiculous in his abilities. He's going to get it done tonight. He's going to find a way, get it done tonight. I understand Chavo Guerrero is a great champion. Twice over. Great champions. One man. But tonight feels real good. Real good.
might be right into the match here. Yeah, we are.
We are. We're jumping right into it. Does Evan Bourne show us? He does indeed. This dude goes fucking crazy. Some of the quickest paced, air obtaining, I guess I mean. This dude, like, floats. It's fucking crazy. One of the greatest high flyers we've ever seen, undoubtedly. And he overwhelms Chavo Guerrero with it. Chavo doing his best to try to keep Evan from, you know, doing all that crazy stuff that he does. But it's like trying to... Oh, man, what's a good thing to say here? It's like trying to hold onto a jar with hands covered in butter. What the hell's that? What is that?
That works, analogy? Technically.
It works, but it's a crazy analogy that I've never heard anybody say before, strangely and I made up myself evocative. For some reason.
Yeah. But yeah, eventually, Evan Bourne overcomes the Chavo Guerrero press and unleashes a flurry of offense, which concludes with his airborne shooting star press, a maneuver that we've never seen executed so beautifully. Of course, we've seen it a couple times from a couple superstars, perhaps none so impressively as Brock Lesnar, but this is a very different shooting star press. This is a perfect shooting star press. Calculated, as you said, perfectly floated, and we might just have seen the future of the cruiserweight division. And new
cruiserweight champ Evan Bourne has done it. Big night for Millennium, and out comes Frankie to celebrate with the boy,
puts him on his shoulders, obviously.
Yep. new champ. And Chavo comes over, he's got the belt in his hand, and he's looking at Evan.
Oh, no, I think he leaves the world title aside for this moment. I think it would be a little undermining if he grabbed it. Or does he? Do you mean he has the cruiserweight title in his hand?
Yes. Sorry. The cruiserweight world title. That's specific. Yeah, he's got the cruiserweight title in his hands, and he's looking at Evan up there, and he kind of wades his way into the center of the ring. You know, it's some bullshit, really, that he's even doing this tonight. But he looks at Evan and he nods and he kind of consoles himself a little bit and passes over the cruiserweight championship to Evan Bourne, and, you know, gives a little nod, prayer, acknowledgement thing. You know what I mean?
Maybe he offers his hand, and then Evan like pauses, and then Chavo says, "Be a man, be a man."
Amazing, be a man. Chavo Guerrero showing humility here. He's not done tonight yet, though.
No, he's already lost one world title tonight, and we. Remember, the folks haven't seen this yet, so I want to stress that going into this event, Chavo Guerrero was a double world champion. He was the cruiserweight and the heavyweight champion of the world, and he has to defend both belts tonight. And actually, at the very first hurdle, he's had a 17-minute war with Evan Bourne, an exhausting contest where he's had to try and pick up a jar with peanut butter all over his hands. And then he's come out the other end. He's no longer the cruiserweight. Just butter. I was adding
peanut
there.
Butter would be like sticky. Come on.
I was imagining peanut butter. Really. Anyway, Chavo's lost this match. What's that going to do to his psyche? What's that going to do to his... Ooh, I almost pulled my mic out there. Can you still hear me?
Oh, yep.
Okay. What's that going to do to his body? And he's still going to fight the Animal Batista for the World Heavyweight Championship. Man, Wembley Stadium's in for a treat tonight.
We see Randy Orton's debut. A third generation star. We see, I believe it was Jim Ross, mm-hmm. who called him down to the ring. His first matchup against Stevie Richards on a SmackDown in
Raw, I think.
Oh, it was a Raw. Oh, cool. On a Raw in 2002. Two.
Yeah.
Yeah. We go backstage, and Amy Weber has a special guest here. It's Jim Ross. Oh my God, he's here for some reason. Jim, you don't even work here. Why are you here? He ignores that question.
Well, they've gone to her. They've gone to him because he was right there at the start of Randy Orton's career, and they want to know, one, what he thought at the time, and two, what he thinks now.
Man, I gotta put on my JR voice, don't I? Shit. You know, the young Randy Orton there. When I first saw him. I mean, you just knew that there would be something about him, right? He'd figure it out eventually, but it's been quick. It's been really quick. And I think that's the most impressive thing for me. This is a guy who had all the tools to eventually put something together, and he was, I mean, pretty much right from the jump, he was ready to go with that. A lot of success early. Tonight, obviously, he's looking for an even bigger success. If he wins this WWE Championship tonight, that's a grand slam, eh? And he like looks up at her. He's like, that's the grand slam right there. That's world title, intercontinental title, tag team titles. He just needs that other world one. And I mean, that's a big thing to have as a 27-year-old. Man, JR fell apart. He stopped talking like JR.
Main eventing at Wembley Stadium as well. I mean, if Randy Orton can get this done tonight, I think it can be unquestioned that he's completed wrestling at the age of 27. He's completed it.
That's so goddamn fucking insane. I can't believe but it.
Remember who's standing in his way. John Cena has been champ for 11 months.
Is this Amy Weber like yelling at JR now?
This is now Putty talking to you, the audience. You know, he's gone through Mark Henry, he's gone through MAGA, he's gone through, you know, the list goes on. His own body's falling apart, and yet still he's the world champion. Randy Orton's great, but as John Cena said a couple weeks ago, you know, Randy Orton's fate, I think, is ultimately to end up as another person on the list of John Cena opponents that he's overcome.
Yeah, not to, like, poke holes in JR here, but, like, Cena's career, as we've already seen, started pretty much around the same time as Orton's did.
Absolutely.
The only reason Cena hasn't, quote-unquote, completed wrestling at 27 or whatever is because he just happens to be 32 right now. Mm. He just happens to be a little bit older when he came in. Obviously, that other world title still hasn't found John Cena yet, but I mean
to be fair, part of the reason why that other title hasn't found John Cena is because he hasn't had time. He's been WWE champion pretty much since he won it, right?
That's true. There you go. We see John Cena win the US title from Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania 20. Big crazy upset that nobody saw coming, but in retrospect we probably all should have seen coming.
Well, it was the start of the John Cena story, right? Up until this point, like you said, it was a big upset because we weren't really talking about John Cena. He was entertaining. He was a fun little guy. But that was when I think he showed that he could win the big one. And then it took a year then for him to get back to the main stage.
It's a guy who, like, yeah, I mean, he beat Brock Lesnar so badly, Brock Lesnar had to retire.
Yeah, we have not seen Brock Lesnar since.
He took his ball and went home. Putty, take it away that taker back.
We join a desert. There is a man or a thing driving a hearse or marshalling a hearse through a desert. It's strange. It's confusing. There's a little girl asking you if you heard the one about the man who keeps coming back. He was buried alive. He was set on fire. But he keeps coming back. And then the guy gets off the hearse and he digs in the ground and he finds a box, and in the box is a strange symbol, a metal symbol of some sort. And then the girl speaks again and she says, he has risen. He's here. And then it's Ken Shamrock who comes out of the ring. He said, I'm sick and tired of these mind games, dead man, but tonight I put it all to bed and I put it all to rest. The video says you have risen. Show yourself. Walk down to this ring and make the point that I've been making ever since I caused you to lose that World Heavyweight Championship. That you are not some otherworldly entity. You are not some supernatural wizard. You are a man and your bones break just like the rest of us. You bleed just like the rest of us. And tonight you're going to lose just like the rest of them. And then the druid sounds play. Lightning strikes the stage. That symbol from the box appears and it's on fire. And he's back. The Undertaker has returned to face Ken Shamrock right here tonight at Wembley Stadium.
This is going to be something, that's for sure. I mean, these guys are both these guys are both top tier brawlers, boy, right? no, but you know, both these guys have great striking. Taker probably has like a pro wrestling knowledge advantage, but I don't know how much that'll do against Ken Shamrock, a guy who just has great knowledge about fighting in general.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to be a wrestling match. I think it's going to be a fight. And I think, honestly, people are underestimating Taker in a fight. He's one of the best pure strikers in sports entertainment.
Yep, very much so. Fucking. Anyways, yeah, here we go.
This should be an absolute clash. These two are going to go at it for, I think, a reasonable amount of time, and we're going to see who the better man is.
Big war incoming.
Yeah. Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh shit. The bell rings and Ken just starts lighting up Taker with these leg kicks. And then Taker, like, is trying to fight back. He's trying to get some punches in, but Ken's, like, dodging most of them. Like, he's able to, you know, back away. And Taker's really not able to land a shot as Ken is just absolutely flaring. We can see Taker's leg starts to get red from how much these leg kicks are absolutely slamming him.
Through his gear?
He's debuting a new look. He's got shorts for tonight.
He's got thighs out.
Taker shorts. He's really, really tight number, you know?
It's fucking hot in England, yeah. Man, alright? Leave me alone.
I like it. I like the idea that Taker does maybe have special ring gear just for this match, and we can see his legs, and they're starting to get red. And at one point, Taker throws a punch. He puts his whole body behind it, and it does catch Shamrock. As he catches Shamrock with all his force, you can see it really rock Shamrock. Taker's leg buckles, and Shamrock, who is clearly rocked from the punch, notices and just moves past it and immediately just kind of wraps himself around Taker and pulls him down into an ankle lock. And then, well, a leg is not meant to bend like that.
Yeah, Ken Shamrock fucking snaps the Undertaker's leg. And our referee's like,
this should not continue.
Yeah, I guess we're done here. This dude can't even fucking stand up. Damn. Josh Matthews kind of comes into the ring. He's like, what the fuck?
That Ken, we're crazy. Were you expecting the Undertaker to show up tonight? Yes, he told me he would. Were you expecting it to be like that? Absolutely. I've been saying it for the last 3 weeks. His bones are the same as the rest of them, and I just proved what happens when you step to the most dangerous man on the planet. But as I said on SmackDown, this is not the top of the mountain. This is not the end. This is not what I came here to do. You all know me now. You all know what I can do. You all know how I've humbled your greatest. He looks down. I'm not here to wrestle in front of 80,000 at Wembley Stadium. I'm not here to prove myself. I've done that over and over and over again. I'm here to win the World Heavyweight Championship. So Chavo Guerrero, Batista, whoever it is, I'm coming for you.
We see Randy Orton beat Rob Van Dam Armageddon 2003 to become the IC champion. It's his first IC title win. His first title win, period. Hell yeah. Todd Grisham is backstage. He's got Chavo Guerrero here with him. And he's going to ask Chavo, you know, how you doing, buddy?
Like, that's such a dumb question, Todd. So just, of course you'd ask such a stupid question. I'm hurt. I'm beat up. I'm rocked. I don't have the Cruiserweight Championship anymore. And now I've got to go in there with the Animal Batista. But you know what? I'm used to that here on SmackDown. Because as always, I am not given the respect that I deserve. And you know what? It's fine. I proved to the world that I could be the Cruiserweight Champion and the World Heavyweight Champion at the same time. All respect to Evan Bourne. He was the better man tonight. That doesn't change the fact that I'm in there with Batista later. And I've proven over and over again that I am better than Batista. I did in 3 seconds what Batista couldn't do in 3 months when I beat The Undertaker for the World Heavyweight Championship. And tonight, I am finally going to be free of Batista. Because when he loses tonight, and he will never be able to challenge for the World Heavyweight Championship again. And that will be a weight off my shoulders. And Tae Long's going to appear in the shot and say, Playa, I just want you to know that I have so much respect for you as the world champion. And I only made these matches because that's what a world champion has to do. Defend their titles. So with all the sincerity in the world, I wish you the best of luck tonight. And I am very proud that you are representing SmackDown as its champion tonight. And Chavo's going to say, you know what, Teddy? I can't even take anything you say seriously anymore. I'm going to represent SmackDown tonight. I'm going to beat Batista tonight. And when I do that, when everyone looks at SmackDown and sees how great it is, the competition, its champion, it's not going to be because of you. It's going to be in spite of you.
Perfect. We see John Cena winning the WWE Championship from JBL, WrestleMania 21. Yeah. First world title.
Yeah. A huge one. He beat somebody who had a similarly long reign to the reigns that he's had.
Yeah, true. 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 Shit. We cut to our commentator, Michael Cole, and Taz. And Taz is like, oh, man, this shit's about to go crazy. Get your children out of the room. We're about to, like, die. Somebody's about to die, all right? There's, like, 80,000 people here. Jeff Hardy's in this match. He will die. He's going to do something, and it's going to be so fucked up. Like, yeah, you just prepare yourself. Good God.
So to clarify, because I don't think we've explained, Brian Kendrick and Paul London are going to defend their WWE Tag Team Championships against the Hardys in a ladder match.
Yeah. Yeah. Based
yeah. It is. The based. We got the based note.
Yeah, we do. We do have the based note. Yeah, these guys go crazy. It's everything you'd expect from this. I like that I can kind of just point at these four and be yep. like ladder match and be like, and you're like, oh yeah, okay. I know how this would work. Yeah, they go crazy. London and Kendrick pull it out. Pull it down. they're still your WWE tag team champions. 8 months in now to this yep. reign.
They won him looking in a ladder match.
There you go.
Hey.
Yeah, they're looking untouchable, really. Tag team champs forever.
And maybe, you know, this is a bit of a stretch, but maybe this match gives Chavo Guerrero confidence, right? Because these were guys who came up from the cruiserweight division and never looked back. These are heavyweight tag team icons now. So even though Chavo was unable to hold on to that cruiserweight title, Chavo is a heavyweight now. So maybe he can pull it out tonight.
We see Randy Orton winning the World Heavyweight Championship for the first time against Chris Benoit at SummerSlam 2004.
This very event.
Yeah, 3 years ago.
SummerSlam has been a good stage for Randy, because not only did he do that, but last year he retired Hulk Hogan here, so...
Bye, brothers. Orton's first World Championship win came against, you know, another guy who... I mean, it's Chris Benoit. Like, what do I have to say? Like, one of the scrappiest dudes ever. Like, yep. A dude who just, like, will not let you win. You know what I mean? You have yep. to earn that shit.
But, I mean, the nature of that victory as well, if you remember, was very spontaneous. Randy Orton is a lethal weapon.
Yeah, that's true. Strike out of nowhere, that guy. Amy Weber's once again backstage. She's with Triple H.
What does she ask him?
Triple H, you're, you know, challenging for the Intercontinental Championship later tonight. How do you feel about that? How do you feel about the Intercontinental Championship,
It's a good question, Amy, because, you know, maybe a couple of years ago I would have seen this as a bit of a step down. But, you know, I've been there. I've won countless world championships. I've been the man. I've been the game. But over the last couple of years, I've started to get back in touch with a different side of me. I've started to let a little bit loose, started to enjoy this business again, this industry, being in there with guys like Elijah Burke. And I think tonight, it's going to be a really good, it's going to be a really good match. And I think the Intercontinental Championship, when if I can win that tonight, is going to be the crown of these last couple of years of the new Triple H. Because I'm not going anywhere. When the game changes, the game changes. And tonight, I'm going to win the Intercontinental Championship, and I'm going to show to everybody that my time is not over. Also, I think it'd be cool if I wasn't the only one wearing gold in this locker room. And then the camera can pan around to women's champion Trish Stratus with a smile on her face.
This... Oh, yeah, right, okay, I know what's going on. We showcase Melina's rise. I mean, she also has been, much like London Kendrick, I think she won that title at New Year's Rev?
I think so.
Start of the year, basically, she's held it now. We're 8 months into that.
She's no longer the women's champion.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, but she did have a really nice long reign.
Yeah, you know what? I've done that like 3 times now on streams where I've called her the women's champion. And you're like, nope. And I'm like, what? What do you mean? And I'm like, oh, yeah, right. Geez. Anyways, yeah, Melina was world champ for like a while. I don't know when that ended. A
couple weeks ago. Yep.
Yeah, Melina kind of went from being somebody we didn't expect to ever be a women's champion to somebody who then was women's champion, and we didn't really believe that. To, well, actually, she's pretty damn good at this, isn't she?
Somebody we didn't believe could lose the women's title.
Yeah, clearly.
true.
Physically impossible for her to lose. Just I think it's impressive how somebody who I guess we didn't really know would be such a big part of this division this year has without a doubt come into her own and just been really just solid, great, great. Yeah, she's just been great. Like everything she's been tasked with, everything that's come her way, she's found a way to do it pretty well. Obviously, the women's title loss is a setback, but with this new thing, this revolution, if you will, which is Melina, Victoria, and Talia Madison, I mean, she looks positioned to probably get there again sooner than later. It's been 8 months. It's been a crazy 8 months. Mickey James comes out to the ring, and she says she's got Maria with her. You know, she promised everybody a big surprise partner, and she's got one. It's Serena Deeb.
Holy shit. Holy shit. Who is that? Who is that?
And this woman comes to the ring and gets in, and I guess she looks like a wrestler.
Well, she's got an aura. No, more than that. She's got an aura of competency, right?
I see.
She's she's in incredibly good shape. Right. She's toned. She's not like overly muscular, but you can tell like she's got a wrestler's body. But she's also just got this sort of like clean look to her. Like she stands in the ring and you sort of know she looks like she belongs to be there. She's standing on her debut in front of almost 80,000 people. And she looks like she belongs. The baby faces need to win this massive 6-woman tag team match?
Good call on that. I like that. We get into it. Here we go.
Well, she certainly turned the tide.
At some point here during this match, Serena just drops Maria. We're like, oh, what the fuck? What the hell? And Victoria will pick up the pieces. Widow's Peak. Wow. What the hell was that about?
Let's turn Serena Deeb.
Yeah, buddy.
And Melina will explain that, have you not been listening carefully, Britain? This industry, this division, this whole world belongs to me. And we are going to revolutionize women's wrestling. So note down the names, Melina Perez, Talia Madison, Serena Deeb, Victoria. This is women's wrestling legacy. This is the future and the present of professional wrestling, and you better get used to it. Because as Mickey James and Maria found out tonight, we're unstoppable. and our brand is growing.
Yeah, I wonder if I should save this for like a raw, but whatever, I'll throw it in there. Melina can say that stuff like this, this Serena thing, is going to keep happening.
Mm-hmm.
Because she has the opportunity. Melina is the key to this shit. You get in with her, and it's fairly smooth sailing. You know what I mean? She's where, I mean, she's like an island in rough tides. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Poured
in the storm.
Yeah. You could either go it alone, and then you're either Nexus or you're against us. There you go. That's what I meant to say.
But actually, I think I like the idea that Melina also stamps it. It says, but this will be the last time, because I found everyone I need. These four women are the future of wrestling. So you've missed the boat.
Awesome. We see John Cena as the WWE champion get drafted over Raw in, like, June of 2005?
Yeah, roughly.
I
think the point of this video is to show how big of a deal that was. Because John Cena...
is a big hero star.
Yeah, he's gone on to be, like, a franchise.
Yeah. Perfect. Here we go.
Here we go.
World Heavyweight title. This is Dave Bautista's last chance.
On the other hand, if Chavo gets disqualified or counted out, he will lose the World Heavyweight Championship tonight.
Yeah, a lot of odds here. What? A lot of, I don't know, a lot of stakes
going on. Yeah.
Yeah, for both guys.
Because remember, Bautista, obviously, his big promise this year was to finish 2007. This was the first time ever Bautista entered a year as World Heavyweight Champion. And his promise was that he would finish the year as World Heavyweight Champion. And I think in Bautista's mind, if he loses tonight, that goal might be over. Because, you know, there's no guarantee Chavo loses the belt this year. So for Bautista, this really is his last chance.
And also in, like, Dave's head, right? He's much bigger than Chavo. He's much tougher than Chavo. He's scarier than Chavo. He's a big fucking guy, Dave Bautista is. And him not being able to get this done, what does that mean for the other people that aren't Dave Bautista? Will he ever get a shot at that belt, like, ever again? Like, if Chavo can get it done tonight, I mean, Chavo said it himself, right? He's kind of home free a little bit. He's got that weight off of him.
And you mentioned it, like, I think Bautista has a ton of respect for Chavo because he is one of the best. But Bautista has a lot of advantages going into this match tonight. And not only that, but this is his third match against Chavo. And on paper, Bautista should be winning this. So I think there's a big weight on Batista's shoulders that twice now he's failed to get the job done. And so even if there wasn't a stipulation here, I think Dave would feel like this is... It's win or go home. You know, it's do or die. But Bautista rises to the big occasion. Although, actually, I can't remember his SummerSlam results. I think he was injured last year during SummerSlam.
That sounds about right to me.
I don't remember what he did at SummerSlam 2005. I think he might have fought for the world title. He was world champion at that time. I think he probably won that match. I don't remember. Maybe Kurt Angle rings a bell.
Sounds right, maybe. Yep.
So Bautista doesn't have a ton of SummerSlam experience or arena match experience, but neither does Chavo. So this could be a really interesting match. It's definitely going to shape the future of SmackDown.
Do you remember if we're right into the match after this?
I think so.
All right. Well, let me say this then. The bell rings. These two kind of eye each other up. They've done this before.
No, I like that they don't eye each other. Bell rings and Bautista charges.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
Fair play
spear.
Then. Bell ring, Bautista charges. Hits a spear right out the gate. He's feeling it. He's feeling good.
Wembley roars.
He gets a couple more power moves on Chavo, like a big gorilla press slam type deal.
I like the idea that, yeah, like, he gets the spear. I like that gorilla press. And then Chavo, like, roll out of the ring. Like, Wembley's electric and Batista's like, and Chavo's like, okay, I gotta take a break. But Batista immediately catches him. He rolls out the other side where Chavo's going and throws him back in the ring. So, like, in the previous matches where Chavo was able to slow down the pace, in this open, Batista's got him. Big spine buster.
Big spine buster. Yeah, I guess. Do we want to go all the way with it here?
I you do what you want to do, man. I'm down for what you're.
All right, yeah, fuck it then. Dave, out of that spine buster, springs right up, looks at the crowd, shakes the ropes. They know what time it is. He gets Chavo up, lifts him up over his head, slams that motherfucker into the ground. Batista bomb, cover, one, two, and Chavo fucking kicks out.
Oh my god.
Dave's like, no? What? Hold on. What the hell?
He says, fuck it, I'm gonna do it again. So he starts, the camera pans back, he starts shaking the ropes, he does the thumbs up. He nods like, yep, this is it. I'm reclaiming what is mine. Thumbs down, picks up Chavo, pulls him back up, and then this time Chavo manages, couple strikes to the head, slinks behind Batista, slinks out of the ring, finally gets some breathing space.
And what we see over the next 17 some odd minutes is Chavo slowly work this dude down. Work him out of it. And obviously Batista is fighting like hell. He knows what this is. But as this gets deeper and deeper and deeper, it's like, yeah, Dave probably should have just had it that early.
I mean, he did. He hit the Batista bomb, bro. What else?
I know, but
what's he
going
to do?
I don't even know. I don't know what to tell you. Hit him with it again, but to actually do it this time. Dave is doing all he can, hitting his moves as much as he possibly can, but Chavo starts to pace him out, and he's out wrestling him. And yeah, Chavo does it.
I mean, he's the best. He's the king.
He gets that guy down on his back. He goes up, hits a big frog splash from quarter of the way across the ring, and he's still the world heavyweight champion. He has done what he needed to do.
He's beaten the Undertaker, and now he's beaten Batista.
Yeah, the two guys who were, you know, all over this belt for the first half of this year have been frozen out now by, I mean, the smallest guy in the whole conversation.
Yeah.
Pretty damn good night to be Chavo Guerrero, all things considered.
I think he breaks even in the end. I think he's not going to be happy he lost that cruiserweight title, but Batista's gone for good.
And it's not like this is necessarily overjoyous for Chavo, because he had the confidence in himself to be able to do this. He had done it twice before.
Yeah. This was the win over Batista, though, that like was definitive. Like, not only can Batista not challenge again, but actually just the other matches, there were asterisks. This one, there's no asterisk. He beat Batista.
Yeah, Chavo figured out the puzzle and fucking worked the big guy down and got it done. Very little question now, to me at least, that's our world heavyweight champion going forward. Like, who else can beat this guy, huh?
Well, I think we know who the next match is.
All right. Well, I might have forgotten about him. Okay, let's be honest.
Look out for SNME Guerrero versus Shamrock coming soon.
Hell yeah. Yeah, and Dave sits in the ring, and he's just like, fuck me, man, fuck me. What the fuck?
He looks at his hand, like sand flowing through it. Just like,
why am I so violent? His head. Why am I not violent enough?
We didn't put it in the angle, but I like the idea that Ray comes out and just like comforts him.
Yeah, comes to collect him and stuff like that. He's like sitting there in the ring, like, what the fuck? And they're like, Ray's like, Dave,
I'm done.
They have more matches.
Ray, I'm done.
I know, but more people have to wrestle.
It's
Dave,
over,
I leave the
Ray.
Ring.
It's
just
over.
Just come out of the ring. Just crawl out. We can do this backstage. Okay, okay. We don't have to. You're embarrassing. Don't cry. There's people here. There's cameras.
Oh, but it's over, right?
They can see you. God damn it. I put a towel over his head. Jesus.
He takes him off through the crowd, New Japan style.
Yeah. Yep, exactly. Perfect. We've got Elijah Burke. Ooh. He's got Dolph Ziggler with him.
Triple H talks like this is a done deal. But what he fails to recognize is that we're not here to take part. We're here to take over. I am the Intercontinental Champion. The New Breed are the World Tag Team Champions. And that ain't going to change tonight. You can't get rid of us that easily because we are not just the future, but we are the present. And tonight I'm going to remind Triple H that I'm just that bit younger and I'm just that bit better.
Here we go. Intercontinental Championship, Elijah Burke defending against Triple H. Oh, never mind. Scratch that.
While Cena was becoming a franchise, Orton was notching scalps. He was taking down legends. He was ending things, becoming accomplished. Right? We talk about John Cena, and absolutely we talk about one of the greatest champions of all time. Three of the greatest championship reigns we've ever seen. But when we talk about Randy Orton, we can just list things he has done and accomplished in this business. Youngest world champion of all time. Beat Mick Foley in a hardcore match. Retired Hulk Hogan. One of the greatest feuds we've ever seen with Shelton Benjamin. He beat Chavo Guerrero, the Royal Rumble winner at WrestleMania, and perhaps to cap it all off, he defeated The Undertaker inside Hell in a Cell. If you look at anybody's resume of things they've accomplished in pro wrestling, I doubt you'll find anyone better than the Legend Killer.
Okay, Intercontinental Championship, question mark?
Maybe. Hopefully. I think so.
Yes. Okay, thank God. Yeah, so you've probably got a vision for this.
A little bit. Like, it's mostly just it's a Triple H smoke and mirrors match more than if you have anything in specific, go ahead.
Not particularly. Triple H. I think Elijah probably does pretty well in this, all things considered. It's not necessarily a one-sided affair or as one-sided as Triple H would probably like you to think it might be.
Oh yeah.
Elijah certainly, there are moments where Elijah has Triple H kind of reeling a little bit on the back foot. Never really an opportunity, I don't think, for Elijah to get it done, to seal the deal. He's never in that position. But Triple H is, after Trish Stratus gets involved, distracts Dolph maybe on the outside.
I'm thinking maybe there's a ref bump and Triple H slides him a sledgehammer.
Trish slides him a sledgehammer. Yep.
Yes. I say Triple H.
Yeah. Triple H slides him a sledgehammer and he's like, it'd be Elijah. Do it. Fulfill the prophecy.
Trish slides him a sledgehammer. They both look at each other with shit-eating grins. Elijah's like, oh, man. And he gets fucking smacked in the head with a sledgehammer.
I like the idea that they both dive for it. Triple H gets it and Elijah goes, fuck. Just gets hit with it and he's done. Pedigree afterwards.
Yep.
Ref comes to one.
Slow three count as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Two, three, my time.
Triple H has won the Intercontinental Championship again.
The power couple has been fulfilled. They are both both champions, and we hate it.
They are both champions.
They're both champions, and we all hate them for it.
Triple H got it done. New IC champion. What we've got left is that main event, Randy Orton, John Cena.
Play Bure.
And I think we have things in between, right?
Yes, there's at least a package.
Excellent. Oh, yeah.
It is.
We've
said so much. I don't know if there's much more to say. We are looking at the two icons of a generation, really. And it's not like we've seen their careers pass. We are like 30% into their peak, right? You know, we're seeing they're like, we're seeing two guys who have defined a generation, the two greatest world champions of the last 2 or 3 years, and they're finally clashing. It was inevitable, but of course, what greater stage than here at Wembley Stadium for John Cena versus Randy Orton for the WWE Championship, a match that no doubt everybody has wanted to see ever since they both became world champion 2 or 3 years ago. And now we're going to finally figure out in front of 80,000 who's better. Who's the man? Who's the guy? Because we're looking at two of the top guys in the WWE. Who is the guy to take this company forward?
Orton comes out. He's ready to go. Cena comes out. He's looking as good as ever. He's got that the tape.
Yep.
Yeah, the tape on his shoulder. You know, Jerry Lawler
brace on his knee as well.
Yeah, Jerry Lawler on comms is like, he's stupid, Joey. Randy Orton knows that those are targets now. Joey's like, we heard Randy.
Randy Orton
pays attention. Yeah, like, all Cena can try to do is just protect himself as best as he can. Like, this is where we're at now. So let's do it. The two biggest guys in this whole goddamn series. WWE Championship.
And I think
fucking near 80,000 people.
The way I described it in the booking, it's a little bit convoluted, but I think it's the way I want to pitch it to you guys, the audience, is that we are seeing shades of both of these men's previous matches here at SummerSlam with Chris Benoit. Because in 2004, Orton beat Chris Benoit for the world title here at this event. And in 2005, John Cena beat Chris Benoit, retaining his title at this event. And I like to think that through the large portions, because like, let's be honest, neither of John Cena or Randy Orton have a natural offense that they are particularly pleasing to watch. Both these guys are sort of seller, reactor, heat, sort of fire guys. And so what I like is that maybe in the first section of the match, Cena's trying to be sort of this gritty grappler in the style of Chris Benoit and try and wear Orton down, try and slow the match down, try and not let Orton pick the pace up. Because even though Orton isn't a particularly quick wrestler, generally speaking, Orton knows where the targets are, and Orton could probably finish Cena pretty quickly if he was given that little bit of pace. And so Cena's trying to stop that. He's trying to prevent that. He's trying to wear him down. And I like to think eventually that morphs into Orton kind of doing more of that super junior Chris Benoit offense. You mentioned, Tucker, a spot that you had in mind.
Yeah, as he's getting worn down and stuff like that, Orton's like running the numbers in his head. Like, he's like a computer to me. He's got to run the numbers. He's running the numbers in his head. He's like playing it back, and he's like, shit, how do I break this? Speed up pace. And he's like, oh, yeah. He remembers SummerSlam 04, big suicide dive onto Benoit. So he manages to push Cena out there and takes a big run up, takes a big old dive on him, speeding it up a little bit to get him in control. And then as Orton goes into it, having like a bit of a control section for him, it's a little brutal, honestly. Kind of embracing that the more rugged side of Benoit, that I don't know, the I guess the rabid Wolverine thing, I guess, if you want.
Open hand strikes. Yeah.
Very aggressive. Yeah, like going right for where he knows Cena is the most fucked up. You know, Cena's still battling through it though, as he always does. But yeah, some good shots, I think.
I think it devolves into sort of these men trading sequences of signature offense. And as most of these main event title matches have tended to go over the last couple of years, it's slowly building towards John Cena getting a grip on this main event. And it slowly is Cena's going through his motions, the power slam into the five knuckle shuffle. And it's at that point that he feels it, that moment where the FU is coming as he feels the audience. Remember, Cena feeds off of this crowd. Feeds off of any crowd he's in front of. This is a 50-50 crowd. Some smarky Brits, 110% going back and forth throughout the match. But as Cena's gaining that momentum, he's winning over the fans because he's that good. And then he kind of takes a step back. The camera pans around. You can see Cena's taking a moment, his hand in the air.
He hits the Rainmaker pose.
Not quite, but he's got his hand in the air, you know, like he's about to do the "you can't see me."
Yep.
And then he stops. And you can see he takes an extended pause just to soak in the moment. You know, we've seen John Cena in hostile territory a lot over the last couple of years, and that sort of cutting out the fans, sort of getting down to business. But Cena knows right now that he is experiencing a moment. These are two men at the absolute peak of their powers, and the fans know it, and this is a moment in time, and Cena's just pulling all that energy from the crowd, and there's a smile on his face because you know he loves it. And he turns around into an RKO. And as always, it's just like that. That's all it takes.
Bang.
And new.
I don't know if it's even like worth saying anything, actually. Which I guess I already ruined by saying something. Damn. 92, up in 14. Want to talk to probably the main, because they were the only thing that really did super fantastic.
Chavo, I would go for the third guy.
Chavo, yeah, who worked twice.
And he did pretty well tonight.
Call hugs for everybody. That's what I do. I give out hugs to my workers. And there you go. SummerSlam 2007. Where do we go from here? Chavo's still at the top of SmackDown, but you know that power is being halved now, I guess. No. No. Stop it. Bad. Bad. You're not allowed to do this to me, game. Fuck you. It's fine. Anyways, Chavo, you know, his responsibility, I guess, has been cut in half. He's now just the World Heavyweight Champion. What does that mean for the Cruiserweight title going forward?
Will Chavo get a rematch?
Are there new opportunities there? There's certainly new opportunities in the World Heavyweight title space, even though Ken Shamrock appears to have called his shot. We've got the new WWE Champion and a new Intercontinental Champion. Lots of things going on here at the end of the summer of 07. And I think when we see you guys next time, it'll likely be an SNME. Yep. Likely the one that Putty alluded to, SNME 10, Guerrero versus Shamrock. I should throw up credits.
Yes.
I gotta do that.
Thank you.
It's a Patreon thing. Thank you so much, people, for, like, bothering. Appreciate it a lot.
I echo that sentiment.
Got like a YouTube comment like the other day, and that was just like, "What, you guys are still doing this, and it's still like fun."
Hey, nice.
And I was just like, "Awesome!" I was like, "That's fantastic to hear, actually."
Yeah, I still think, you know, there as we move through the years, there are portions of this that become more interesting.
Yeah. For sure.
For sure. Yeah.
I mean, yeah. We'll talk about that afterwards.
Be quite reflective, but I think that's something to happen off the episode. But just thank you all for watching, and yeah, we'll see you guys next time.
All right, sounds good, folks. We'll see you around. Peace. There we go. We're out on that.
I really liked that show.
Yeah, that felt really good. Jesus, wow.
Especially that main. I liked how that went.
Yeah, I like doing it for both world title matches. Honestly. This guy's leaving, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought so.
I'm thinking, by the way, just like
fair. TNA Homer over here, bro.
Just to get this out there, because I'm not sure how much of it I've told you. I think for the Cruiserweights, I've got a very clear idea of where we're going. We're just going to do Evan celebrates, and then Roddy turns on him, and then we just do Roddy, Evan, Kazarian's choice. He doesn't know who to decide. We'll bring up Kid and what's his name? Jack Evans, right? Kid and Jack Evans.
Was that what we were going for?
They're going to be the new Millennium Tag Team. So they're going to join Roddy when he wins the belt back. They're going to debut as interference in the Evan-born-Roddy match.
Who was the Dragon Nakamura partner?
I don't remember. We can check that. It might have been Jack Evans.
Yeah, I think it was Evans.
I think we could maybe find someone else. I think Jack Evans and Tyson Kidd is a cool Millennium Tag Team. Do you agree? Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, no, I fully agree with that. Hell yeah.
Because obviously Evans was in Generation Next, and I think Tyson Kidd, considering he's no longer a part of the Hart family, I think it's a good
he's free.
Ian. Free, he's free. I don't know if it's free. I think that's a downgrade, but I think with Millennium he'll have an in. And then for the world title, even though we said it would probably be an SNME on the show, I think maybe we're just going to do it on TV. I guess we can talk about that more. I guess it's Chavo and maybe base Chavo we trust, but I'm feeling like maybe that's just more of a TV main event. I also think Born Roddy is screaming out me is more of an SNME match, honestly.
Okay.
But I think in booking that SummerSlam, I think there was a little bit of a scratch away that you're not as high on Evan Bourne as I am. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm really high on Evan Bourne. Like, I think he's just it. He's the guy of the Cruiserweight division.
Interesting.
He's just so flippy. He's like, he is like an early 2010s Cruiserweight here in 2007.
Is that just like a real take on Seidel?
Yeah. He is in the New Japan Juniors division in the mid 2010s. And he fits perfectly fine. Like, he's just, like, I don't think he's exceptional, but it's like if you said to me we could have Will Ospreay in 2007. It's like, he's not quite on that level, but it's like, he's not far off.
That is fucking crazy. Yeah, that's right. You're right on that.
He's like 85% of a Ricochet, right? Which in 2007 is crazy.
That is nuts. That's like, your mind doesn't even work anymore, man. Your face melted off.
He's also apparently over as fuck right now. Holy.
Chavo's doing fine. How's Big Dave? Yeah, Dave's Dave.
But yeah, no, I think, so I don't see Evan Bourne as like this transformational worker or anything, but he is just like a cruiserweight before his time. Like, he is just like what Ray and Chavo and Tajiri were in the early 2000s, that is who Bourne is now.
No, I feel that, certainly.
And like, Roderick I really like, but he's not that. Like, he's a great worker, but he's not that. He's not going to be doing the things that Evan Bourne is doing.
No.
Bourne is the sort of transformational, holy shit, it's the future now guy. And that's the effect he had in the WWE. And the only reason I think why Bourne... Well, there's two reasons, obviously. But, like, aside from the real-life shit, where he obviously had a lot of drug pops and whatever...
Did they fire him for the drug pops?
I think they did.
Okay, that would make more sense, because in my head I was like, no, he got in that car accident. They were just like, get out of here.
But like, aside from the drug pop stuff, because he had a couple of years where they weren't too bothered about it and he didn't get popped that many times, the reason why he doesn't reach like crazy levels is just because there's no division for him. If there was a cruiserweight division for Evan Bourne that was as over as ours, he'd just be crazy. He'd be so over. So like, I'm definitely pushing the idea that like, this guy is, he's our top babyface in that division now. That is just who he is.
It is still massively weird to me that like, Matt Sydal was like WWE tag team champion with Kofi Kingston for like 9 months or something.
And that was super over as well. Yeah.
It was hella over. It's just like, it's so weird to me to be like, yeah, no, that's the same guy. It's like, I don't know. I guess it's because I didn't know anything before, right? I came into him being in WWE already. So him coming out afterwards as like a weird transient mountain man was like, oh, that's really crazy. And it's like, oh no, never mind. You were always like that. Okay, I gotcha. Yeah, I don't know. It just is always like shocking me to be like, yeah, no, Matt Sydal was like just the tag team champion, the sole tag team, one half of the sole tag team titles in WWE during that time. Like,
yeah,
it's crazy.
He came in as a big, like I said, he came in as a big deal, and he lit the world on fire because he's an incredibly exciting worker. He's out of his time. But there just wasn't any outlet for that. Because they were never going to be willing to let him do anything towards the top end of the card. I think he does win the US title. I might be incorrect on that, but I think he does.
Maybe he did. I don't even know.
Because he gets super over. Because it's like, of course he does. He's doing crazy shit. No, he doesn't win the US title. But, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I think so. I thought it was just the tag belts. But,
But like I said, but I think that run, he's very clearly, you know, close to the top of the show, really, at that point. So. But yeah, we'll probably have to look at our schedule for between now and Survivor Series. I think, I guess, to set our, like, what are we doing at Survivor Series, I think it's still probably, for me, Kennedy, Orton, and Batista, Taker, Hell in a Cell.
Yeah, I like both those.
I don't know. I guess we really oversold the Undertaker thing. Like, not over... Like, we should have sold it hard. But I feel like maybe going as far to say as his leg's broken might have been a bit... Although, then again, we could just use it to reinforce that he is actually a wizard. And he just magically heals the bone. That could be
kind
of...
He should, like, zap his leg. Yeah, also, no, yeah. I liked it. Yeah, no, I liked it, like... Like a ton.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Nailed the fuck out of that whole thing. Yeah, like, I don't even really... Maybe it's just because, like, I don't give a shit about Taker at this point. But I'm like...
And I do, say, to be clear.
Not in our save specifically, but, like, I don't care about, like... I don't know. That's not, like... I don't even know what I'm talking about. But, yeah, I guess I just don't care to that degree. So, like... Be like, oh, maybe we did that too much with him, but I'm like, no.
It's just because he's coming back in two months, not because I think we buried him. I just like that. My only worry is like, you know, him coming back from a broken leg in 2 months.
Ah, that's normal undead wizard shit, man.
Am I wrong, or is that a big overness gain for Mr. Shamrock there?
I think that's the same. Oh, you're
right.
That
is a huge overness. Okay, maybe he's gotten over the hill a little.
Maybe. He's already over the hill.
yeah, true.
Yeah, shit, good stuff. Yeah, kind of sitting here in it, like, fuck yeah, that really worked.
Just trying to think of anything else, just booking-wise, that I want to talk about, because it's a good time to, like, have our heads on straight. I guess, is there anything that you're, like, not sure what we're doing with, that you're like, oh, what's this guy doing, or anything like that, so we can maybe make sure that we're not, like... The thing with sometimes is we'll go into like big periods of build, and I'll be building towards, let's say, this Hell in a Cell match, and if you don't know that, then it can often, I think, be a bit of a boundary to putting shows together. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because I think where we are right now, we're nowhere near that Batista Taker Hell in a Cell match, but you know it's happening, and you know we're getting there, so
yeah,
we can work towards it.
What does the DMLS stuff look like now?
I think it's roughly we try and save as much of it as we can. In that, I think Charlie's going to be going. I think it's Charlie winning the tag belts. I think, and that's going to be him proving his point, and then Regal will agree and go away, and yeah, and then maybe Charlie then loses the tag belts to Shelton or something. And then we salvage that part of the story that way.
I like that. That works.
Or maybe it's Charlie and Shelton winning the tag belts. Because that's kind of heat.
That would probably be better, I think. Charlie and Shelton win that, and then it's like...
Regal goes away because he trusts those guys, and then they have their own differences about how they want to teach the children. And then that can lead to the old idea we had that you might not even remember, where Charlie gets an apprentice and Shelton gets an apprentice.
I do remember that, yeah.
I think that ends up cutting out the Ted DiBiase as a psychopath stuff a little.
That's true, yeah. It does cut out Psycho Ted. Unfortunate.
Unless we somehow do it so that Regal sticks around, we add a third young boy, and so Regal gets Ted, and then... We got a third young boy, and Shelton gets one, and Charlie gets
Alpha
one.
Alpha Junior.
Oh, that's not a terrible idea.
Do we even have Alpha Junior? No. What's his name in here?
What's he's his in this name?
He's in here. There he is. Alpha Junior. He's not good.
We can get him. He's not bad.
Oh my god, he's got star qual for some reason.
He's not bad. He'll do.
Big Alpha Junior time.
Rock and Umaga, deuce.
Everybody loves Alpha Junior.
Another Samoan. Yay.
I'd be down to just get up right
down.
Now.
Yeah, I'm down. A year works for me. Yeah.
Yeah. That works. Cool. Get in here.
Awesome. And then we somehow split them off into... And then... And then the moral of the story could be... The three young boys realize that the... Like, not realize necessarily, because I don't think this is the moral we want to tell. But they get it into their heads that actually the old fucks don't know what they're talking about. And so they join back together and break free.
They break free.
They beat up Regal, DiBiase, and Shelton.
I like that. That's awesome. That's awesome. That's some fun shit.
And then they could just go and join Orton. Just immediately.
Yeah, they
could just,
like, wander over. Yeah, who cares? That's fine. They could be like, no, we should determine our own destiny. Wait, this guy's cool, though. So.
He's got a belt, though. I mean, actually...
He clearly knows what he's talking about.
There's maybe a world in which all of the Orton... Kennedy stuff is resolved by the end of November, and then we have a December free where we can just do Orton versus like Shelton or versus Charlie, and then that's how we do it. So it's like Charlie just gets a title shot, and then during that title shot all the young boys just join Orton, because Orton is a young boy, right?
Yeah,
is Orton's age compared to Shelton and Charlie, though?
Randy Orton is 27.
So how old is Shelton Benjamin and Charlie Haas?
Shelton is 32.
Good. Okay, he was the one I was expecting to be young-ish.
Charlie is 35.
Yeah, all right. Randy Orton is notably younger than those two men.
Yes.
So I think it would make sense in storyline for them to be like, you're old, but Orton is young. Like, how old is... Cody's not that much younger than Randy,
Cody's
right?
22.
Oh, he's considerably younger. But is Ted?
Ted's 24.
Okay, so they're also, like, there's three generations here, isn't there? There's the Charlie Shelton generation, there's the Orton generation, and then there's the young boys generation. There are three separate generations there, I think.
Yep.
And actually, there's a fourth if you include Regal, because he's in a higher...
Oh, yeah, true. Yeah. He's even older.
Yeah, he's 40... No, he's only 39. He's only 39, yeah. And then we probably at some point need to think about whether or not we want to salvage Regal as a long-term member of our wrestling roster. Because I think we've done really good things with him since he came back, but like it's very much a, well, once this is over, he feels like he might be done kind of vibe. Whereas,
yeah, he might just end up floating around. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that.
So...
There's probably room for him as a road agent, though.
Oh, absolutely. Or as a color commentator. He was great at that. And I think he would be good at that. Or as a general manager, even.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. You've got 1,000 different things to keep him around. So, good on that.
But I think there's a part of me that says he's still got a worker in him.
Yeah.
It's just about... It's a shame. I think that there was a world in which Regal's in the Shamrock spot.
Probably, yeah. But... I mean, we have Ken Shamrock, and that's really cool.
So. I'm glad you've come around on Shamrock. You were really down on Shamrock at the turn of the year.
He is not great in the game, but he's Ken fucking Shamrock.
Yeah.
He's fucking awesome. He's like the craziest fucking dude ever. Like,
and I always have to remind myself, and I hope you continue to remind yourself, that what Shamrock is replacing, in essence, is the Great Khali.
Yes.
So, you know, whatever we chose to do, it would surely be an upgrade.
Yep. Yeah, that's... Yeah. Yeah. Fuck.
Okay, other than that, I think, unless we've got anything else to talk about, what I will say to you is I want you to go and go watch some Evan Bourne from those early years.
Just, yeah, all right. Yeah,
even if it doesn't prove my point, I want you to get your own opinion on what the potential was there. And then, yeah, we can talk about it some more. Because I don't want to just push upon you that, like, he was this... you know, next big thing kind of guy without you having your own opinion.
In my brain too, like, I think, I mean, he's still flippy and stuff like that, but I think when he came out of WWE and stuff like that after the leg break, he wasn't quite as, you know?
I think he gets flippier over the years, to be honest. Maybe to a point.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, fair but enough. I think that, like, you know, some would argue that he was confined a little bit in WWE.
Right, yeah.
But yeah, I couldn't really talk to what you're saying. I my impression is generally that when he's on the indies is a little flippier, but just because of the nature of the beast. But he was still like, you know, he was still, you could feel there was, like, I think Park is another good example of a guy who, like, oh man, this guy's just different. Like, this is a different level we've experienced here. I think Ospreay and Ricochet are good examples as well, but they're like, with Ospreay and Ricochet, they're like, they're levels above. But even then, like, Sydal literally hangs with both of those guys for a couple of years, and doesn't look out of place. So, you know, I'm not saying he's as good as them, but it's 2007, right? You know, he is, considering he's anywhere near those guys in 2007 is, you know, it's night and day. Especially, like, again, I think Ray's a good example, right? Where Ray is completely revolutionary, but, like, compare Ray Mysterio to Evan Bourne, or Matt Sydal more specifically. Like, there's a difference. Well, I mean, there.
Especially WWE Ray is, like, toned down to hell. Mm-hmm. Like, you do Hurricane Ranas, and that's, like, that's all you do, buddy.
Tilt Worlds. Yeah.
Yeah, that's your offense, pal. You can't do any fucking flips. Compare that to, like, 97 WCW Ray, who's like, woo! Going fucking crazy.
And the great thing about Ray is that he's so savvy and he's got a great head for the wrestling and he's the best TV worker of all time, arguably. And so even with that level of offense, he's like one of the best to have ever done it on TV. So, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Which is something Sydal doesn't really have.
That, that's true. Fair. Yeah, if you tone down Sydal, he's kind of just the guy.
Yeah. Yeah. He's not that guy. But when you let him be crazy, then he is crazy. So
yeah,
and that's why we've got guys like Roderick Strong, who is that guy.
Big bass himself.
Yeah, that's cool. I don't know what happens after Roddy wins the belt off of Evan. Probably Evan chases for a bit,
figure out when the fuck this guy's back in 6 months.
Or if we're even gonna continue pushing this guy now.
Get out of here, dude.
I don't know. The universe is telling us. He's injury prone. He's, what was he on? Pills? Drugs, pain pills?
Painkillers.
Yeah, so. I don't know. Have I told you about this guy we've got down in Dev? He's Ghanaian, but I think if we make him Jamaican, it'll get more over with the audience.
He should be Jamaican, and then we should just, like, drop it a couple weeks in.
That's a really good idea, actually.
But keep all the Jamaica theming for some reason.
Because Jamaica's cool.
Yeah, we just won't explain it. His name will be Kingston from Ghana, and we won't. Yeah, it'll be fine.
Yeah. Yeah. But, I mean, the Cruiserweight division's pretty healthy now. Although I say that, I mean, outside of Millennium, who else is in the Cruiserweight division?
I don't know.
Hmm.
The Hurricane.
That's true already. That's true. Helms can come back to it. Has Helms done too much with the boys?
No.
That's an option.
I don't think so. Hold on here.
We get old man fucking Helms. Grouchy. I was going to say, we can get Minoru Suzuki Helms.
Maybe we did a little bit of it, but not really. This wasn't even for a belt. This was just like a match.
Yep.
Yeah,
so that's there. I think Helms is an interesting one where I struggle sometimes to get super excited about him anymore. But he could be fun. He could be fun. I don't want him to be, because I feel like he was whiny bitch man for so long. And I just don't want to keep making him whiny bitch man.
Should I give you this pitch? I probably should. God damn it. Go on. I thought about this, and I was like, this is a bad idea, but it's fun, and it could work, and it might breathe life into, like, the Hurricane thing a little bit. I'm like, what if, because, like, original Hurricane is very much just, like, a superhero, right? He's like a Superman, Green Lantern type guy, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, what if we got, like, a Hurricane very much inspired by Batman?
Okay.
He's, like, this angry, violent, brooding guy.
Vigilante who uses gadgets.
He's blowing shit up. He's like, like I almost think like that. Have you seen that the older Hurricane look?
I wonder if there's something to that where it's like he. Maybe he's anti-Flip.
It's not really giving what I wanted, but I like this, like the fucking mask in this era, at least, with like the hair as it is.
Wait.
This was like 09?
09?
Yeah.
That's not early. I thought you said early Hurricane.
No, sorry. No. I shouldn't have said that if I did. My bad.
Wait, also, Hurricane in 09? No way.
Yeah. Yeah, dude. You not know about this?
No, I don't.
He had like a second run.
Did he?
No.
Oh, I see it here.
Came back as the Hurricane. Nostalgia from 7 years ago, pal.
Horror pops.
Yeah, I think he was like a joke. Like, just entirely a joke. Hold on, we've got a video from WWE from May 5th, 2010 called Introducing Hurricane.
May 5th, 2010? Because he got released in February 2010.
Alright, this is weird then. What is this video going to be? What the fuck is this video?
Send it to me, bro.
I did.
No, you didn't.
Oh, no, I didn't. I said that the wrong guy. Fuck. I've been sending everything the wrong guy.
I have
guy
not
then.
Seen anything about the Hurricane so
fucking
far.
Fucking my bad, dog. My fucking bad. I just had to like message that friend. My fucking bad, dog. I'm in the wrong chat sending all these wrong things.
He's gonna my think bad, you're really me. Into the Hurricane, bro.
He will. He'll be like, what the fuck is this shit you're sending me, pal?
Okay, this is quite interesting.
Wait, what the fuck? He's interviewing himself. What the fuck is going on, bro? Well,
that's very fitting
it's
to what we're, yeah,
album.
What we're
it's
doing.
The album? It's the Green Goblin angle. What the fuck is happening?
Should we... Again, I'm going to bring it back to this because you didn't really respond. What if part of his vigilante thing is he's anti-Flip? So he doesn't like flyers.
It feels whiny to me.
Yeah, but he's not going to talk about it. He's just going to beat the shit out of anybody who flips. Hell, we could use the no flips, just fist.
Hell yeah.
Like, I envision this, if you're going to go for vigilante Batman Hurricane, he doesn't do a lot of talking.
No.
Yeah. Ooh, and his signature could be the no ropes match.
So you're saying he was released in February?
That was what Wikipedia said.
This video is from May 5th, 2010. The Hurricane is interviewed by Gregory Helms about his first match.
Maybe it's like a rerun or something?
I don't even know. Because, like, I mean, all the footage that they're showing is of him from, like, later on is from this run that they're talking about. Yeah. And I don't know what his first match is.
Wait, that's not 100% true, I don't think. There's some Ric Flair stuff in here.
There's
some old footage in there for sure, yeah.
But as you get like halfway through, if you get past like the minute 40 or so, minute 50 or so mark, it's just all new shit.
So look. Oh, yeah.
Like, my wins are numerous, Citizen Helms.
Well, I like that Citizen Helms, because he was Hurricane Helms at this point.
Yes.
I don't hate this. I think we'd have to workshop it. I think we've got slightly different visions about where it's going.
Either way, that was an idea I had. I was like, what if we'd like went like the opposite direction of a superhero? No, I don't think anybody's ever like done that. When they do a superhero angle, you're like, I love... never mind, I won't say that. That would not be...
So we're exploring what if it was Batman, but Batman was a dick.
Well, Batman is a dick.
But... Batman's not a dick.
Oh, Batman's a dick. Don't get it twisted.
So we're doing the Invincible / The Boys take on Batman.
Yes.
Yeah. You haven't even... Actually, this reminds me. Because you did like these things about Cody Rhodes being Homelander. You haven't even seen The Boys, have you?
No.
No, didn't think so. Because you don't watch... You actually don't watch television.
I don't, no. No. I do not.
Which is wild to me, considering the type of person that you are. You've got so many literary takes, but you consume very little media.
It's just, what can I say?
It's just wrestling and video games.
Hell yeah. That is it, pretty much.
Yeah. The two worst written forms of media in existence.
The two most garbage forms of media ever. Carried by the wrestling. Carried by the gameplay.
True.
Yeah.
All right. I think that's a good place to leave it. Right. Thank you all for watching. I hope you've all enjoyed. The VOD's going to be up. Not the VOD, but the video is going to be up on Patreon in a couple days. And hopefully we'll see you soon for the fallout and the build to Survivor Series. See you then. Peace.